Welcome to our daily broadcast here at the We Don't Have Time studio in Glasgow. This is the sixth of our broadcast here from the diplomatic zone at COP26 in Glasgow. And we also bring in voices from our hubs in Stockholm, Washington, D.C., and also in Nairobi. Today's highlights will be youth activists that we bring up here on stage, and also voices from our guests joining us on the broadcast. And also our highlight is Marco Rudzinic, who will be here with us in the studio. Marco Rudzinic is founder of NOAA Advisors Limited and also NOAA Conference and Tech Solutions. My name is Katarina Rolfsdotter-Jansson. I am hosting this event always every day together with my colleague Nick Nuttall.
Yep, that's great.
Who was
great.
Present at the first ever COP, and also he was communications director at the COP in Paris. So Nick, tell us a bit, or the audience a bit, about this week's broadcast and what's coming further.
Yeah, well, we've been looking at some of the companies, some of the organizations, some of the people that are really trying to walk the talk in terms of achieving a halving of emissions by 2030 that can set the stage for net zero in 2050. And I think we're focusing very much today on voices of people, but also voices of individuals that are actually doing something with the whole tech center, with the investment center, the whole concept of sustainability, prosperity through digitalization.
And today's theme is building momentum for change. And on that note, I'd like to invite up here on stage our Green Zone correspondent, Anita Soyne. Please join us, Anita. I know you've been up to some pretty exciting stuff during your first week here at the COP. And Anita joins us every day here on stage to give us an update on what's happening outside of the diplomatic zone. So Anita, what has happened the past, well, let's say 24 hours?
The past 24 hours has been a very, I'd say still a challenging time for young people, because today I had an opportunity to interact with most of them, including Alexandra, who will be here with us today.
I hope she'll make it. Yeah, I haven't seen her yet, so we'll just keep fingers crossed.
Yeah, sure. We also were able to meet U.S. senators, that's Ed Markey and Jeff Markey. And I really loved the fact that today in the room we had four climate activists from different corners of the world, where they gave us a platform to tell our stories of how we and those around us are directly affected by climate crisis. So it was more of a listening ear, I could say so. And they also talked about how the U.S. is going to cut their emissions by 50%, that is by 2030. And another thing they emphasized on is that the environmental defenders have to be protected, as well as climate refugees, to be protected. And they also promised to help us in voicing out the issues. Another thing is that Alexandra
For the people that, well, she's world famous by now, but Alexandra Vilsenor.
She is a climate activist, 16 years, and she is so inspiring. And a few days ago, she made a tweet that went viral on the challenges that young people are going through. And I was so happy to see her speak on behalf of the activists from the Global South. So we felt like we are not alone. We are also having support from the Global North.
Yes. Excellent. And there she is. Join us. Wow. Alexandra Vilsenor. We're so happy to see you. Just step up on stage. Terrific. Join stepping next to Anita. Well, Alexandra, terrific that you made it. We were very happy that you did. I got to spot your face there. So tell us, yesterday was the big Fridays for Future March. What was it like?
Well, it was amazing. There were so many young people here in Glasgow, but also all around the world who are protesting. And I always think that it's so empowering when young people come together, especially when it's around these global days, these big conferences, because youth are basically the ones who hold our world leaders accountable. And so when we're outside protesting, it's a way for us to hold our world leaders accountable to make sure that they know that we're watching them, and we're watching them to make sure that they take the right actions. things. And so of course there's young people in here, obviously not enough young people and those who are most affected by the climate crisis, but that just shows that outside of this, we're coming together to make sure that we're still making our voices heard, whether we're in the room or not.
Thank you very much, Alexandria. And today there was the Global Climate March. Give us an update, because we've been stuck inside here all day.
Well, there were a lot of young people out there too. Well, actually, people of all ages out there protesting, and there was a hundreds of thousands of people out there protesting.
Here in Glasgow.
And so even though it was in wind and rain, there are still people out there protesting, because what we face today with the weather will be nothing compared to what we'll face in the future with climate change. So in a way, it's a comparison of we're protesting now, no matter the conditions, to show that in the future it'll be even worse. So we have to do something now.
And we see footage from all over the world. One of my daughters sent in a video from her protest march in Amsterdam. So it's all over the world, which is really, really, it brings a lot of hope. Speaking of hope, Alessandria, what are your hopes for the outcome of this big event?
Well, I was thinking about it, and COP26. We have had 26 of these, where every single year, for 2 weeks straight, we all get together. And by the end of it, we're all so tired, we can't even think about what we want. And so we need to have action right now, because I've been having conversations about the next COP 2 years away, even COP 40. And what I want to see is that we have action right now, not thinking about what we're going to do next year, not thinking about what we're going to do in 2030, but what type of action we're going to take right now. And so that is what I'm focusing on, is making sure that world leaders know that we have to do something right now. And that's why it's important that we have young people in the conversation, because a lot of world leaders think about the climate crisis in a way that it's something that's going to happen in the future. And so the ones who are affected by the climate crisis have to be here reminding them that it's happening right now. And so we need bold climate action, not thinking about what is politically possible, but thinking about what we have to do in order to have a livable future. And so we have to think creatively and have our imaginations there to make sure that we get the right solutions.
Well, thank you very much, Alexandria. And thank you very much, Anita, for joining us. And just keep at it. That's all I can say. Thanks a lot. So, Nick, wonderful guest.
Yes. Yeah, amazing.
Round of applause.
Absolutely
here in the studio.
Fantastic, yeah.
Wonderful. So, Nick, what's ahead now at the COP? We look back further but what's ahead?
Well, you know, we're just coming to the end of the first week, and then we've got the second week. I think we're hoping that the second week is going to be a little bit more visible, how the governments are going to move this agenda forward. I mean, the positive thing listening to Johan Rockström, the great scientist, last night was, in his assessment, the pledges, particularly the new one from India, moves us potentially, because they are pledges, onto a 1.9 degree centigrade world. Now that's a damn sight better than it was when the pledges were put down at Paris for the national determined contributions. But again, they are pledges, they have to be realized. But Rockström was interesting. He felt, as a scientist, a little bit more optimistic about what was happening in our world, and that governments were swimming in the same direction in the swimming pool. Whether some of them are actually doing maybe a backstroke and going in the wrong direction, others will better judge. But he felt that things were moving forward. So I think it's important that the kids and the young people and the older people get out on the streets and show their face. Yeah, you have to show your face sometimes and let people know that you're watching and you're listening and you want action. But let's hope it keeps moving forward. Yeah,
absolutely. Speaking of moving forward, these numbers are moving way too fast.
Yeah, they're moving way too fast in the wrong direction. You know, the International Monetary Fund came out with these numbers that the world is spending $11 million per minute on subsidizing fossil fuel subsidies. And we decided to actually put up a counter that shows how much money the governments have spent on fossil fuel subsidies since the COP started. Now, what's interesting is it's now just gone over the $100 billion mark, which is exactly what the exactly what the developing countries have been asking for ages, since Copenhagen in 2009, that the rich countries would provide $100 billion to help them get on track with their climate ambitions. So let's watch this counter. Where's it going to end? But if you took that money right now, right, and started investing it in a green transition, what a much faster transition we would have.
Oh, dear. Yes. So on that note, let's look at the video that's also connected to this campaign from UNDP.
Listen up, people.
You're headed for a climate disaster. And yet every year, governments spend hundreds of billions of public funds on fossil fuel subsidies. Imagine if we had spent hundreds of billions per year subsidizing giant meteors. That's what you're doing right now. Around the world, people are living in poverty. Don't you think helping them would make more sense than, I don't know, paying for the demise of your entire species? You've got a huge opportunity right now as you rebuild your economies and bounce back from this pandemic. So here's my wild idea. Don't choose extinction. Save your species before it's too late. It's time for you humans to stop making excuses and start making changes. Thank you.
This is such a great campaign, such a great campaign. Please share it on Don't Choose Extinction. Hashtag Don't Choose Extinction. I said in the intro of this broadcast that we have hubs, and let's now go to the first hub for this this check-in. It's our hub at Mount Kenya University in outside of Nairobi. And with us there we have Dr. Robert Ngunda Josephine. And Robert has a big crowd in the studio every day, and it's late in the night when we finish our broadcasts from here from Glasgow. But they are very involved, and there's a lot of engagement in Nairobi for climate action and lots of work connected to the We Don't Have Time platform. So let's see if we can connect with Dr. Robert Ngunda Josephine. Wonderful. There is Nairobi. And hello there, Robert.
Hi.
Wonderful.
Hi,
and I see in the background, I see Patrick. And
yes,
I'd like
yes,
to start to congratulate Patrick. But Patrick
yes.
Kiari is the We Don't Have Time representative in Kenya. And he was just, I think it was yesterday, given the word that he has been nominated as one of the 10 most influential youth activists in Kenya. So a warm, warm congratulations to Patrick Kiari.
Well done.
Excellent work, Patrick.
Well done.
Excellent. Yeah. So just to see you're up and running, and you'll be joining us later with input and questions. So hello for now in Nairobi.
Hi, Katarina.
Okay.
Yes, we are very excited today. Yes, we have news from Patrick, but also on our panel today we have Geoffrey Mboya, who is also the youth advisor for We Do Not Have Time, and he's also a youth activist. Also, we have Lame Kopio, who is also a youth advocate and Rotary actor, and Peter Kamau, who currently works with We Do Not Have Time Kenya. So they're going to be sharing their experience with trying to rally young people to join the climate action. So we are really eager and looking forward for the discussions today. Yes, and we'll be joining you with Geoffrey Boyer for the main panel on your side very soon. And we're looking forward to that. Thank you very much, Catalina. Yes, over to you.
Thank you very much, Robert. And let's now go to Stockholm, to our hub in Stockholm, where Stockholm is the headquarters of We Don't Have Time. And of course, we have a hub there.
Hi, Katarina and Nick.
Hello, Sarah. Hello, Sarah Shaban. Happy that you are with us here. I'm going to put my headphones on because I cannot
yes.
hear you very well. Let's see.
Okay. Can you hear me now? I hope so.
Yes, it's a bit better now.
Okay. I'm very glad to be back here on the sixth day of our broadcast. I think that as Anita and Alexandra showed us, the thousands of people that marched the streets yesterday in Glasgow and all around the world, and again today, really showed us how actual today's theme is. And I'm really looking forward to hearing from all these youth activists that we'll have with us this evening, and as well hearing from the Allrise campaign and their Planet versus Bolsonaro campaign that I've been following since the beginning and then launched them last month. So I'm very excited for tonight, and I have with me David Olson from We Don't Have Time.
Hello. Hello, glad David. To be joining as well, co-hosting with Sarah. Very excited too about tonight's broadcast. Back to basics, in a way, talking about raising the alarm and really pushing for action on climate. through the voices of young people and old people demanding change, and that's basically why We Don't Have Time started. And I'm particularly very keen on hearing from Facing Future and about the legacy of their founder, Stuart Scott, who was on our board until he unfortunately passed away this summer. And to hear more about that, he gave one of the most powerful presentations I've ever heard, actually, on climate. So looking forward to that very much.
Thank you very much, David Olsen. And David is co-founder of We Don't Have Time. Mm-hmm. And now over to the president of the U.S. operations of We Don't Have Time, Swetha Chakraborty.
You nearly invited Joe Biden on there, didn't you?
Well,
yeah,
I'm just as happy to see Swetha Chakraborty.
Yeah, she looks a bit different to Joe. I think that's one thing we can be absolutely certain about.
So the president of U.S. operations, Swetha Chakraborty. Hello there, Swetha. How are you today?
Hi there. And to be fair to you, Katarina, we are just blocks away from President Joe Biden. So it's not too out of the potential to invite the president onto this live broadcast that we're hosting from Washington, D.C. We really just are steps from Capitol Hill. And it's been a really exciting week here in Washington. So while diplomats were at COP26 discussing pledges, we were also moving through Congress, President Joe Biden's Build Back Better agenda. And we are hopefully what is moments away from actually seeing this pass into reality, which would be $555 billion in climate investment in American infrastructure, in jobs, in a clean energy future. And it really would showcase how some of these pledges can become reality. And the United States, as historically the worst polluter of carbon emissions, that is monumental. It can really show that this is how we can overhaul our country, we can overhaul sectors, and it can really pave the way for countries that are potentially hesitant or resistant to this transition. So it's been a really exciting week here in Washington, D.C. We're looking forward to seeing where next week takes us at COP26. And after our broadcast ended yesterday, we actually had a congressman come to the Washington, D.C. hub, and we're excited to show that interview to our audience in a little bit. So looking forward to that. Thanks a lot. Back to you, Katarina.
Excellent, Swetha. Excellent. So it's now my pleasure to introduce the first keynote speaker of this broadcast tonight. First keynote is actually a pre-recorded interview, and it's with the author, Dr. Paul Behrens. He is assistant professor of environmental change at Leiden University, and he has written the book, The Best of Times, The Worst of Times, Futures from the Frontiers of Climate Science. The book describes humanity's current trajectory and possible futures in paired chapters of pessimism and also hope, on topics including economy, energy, land, and population. And our reporter, Markus Lutemann, has done this interview. He got a moment here today with Paul outside the Green Zone. So let's listen to the interview now.
So happy to stand here with Paul Behrens. You've just been in the Green Zone for the first time. What's it like in there?
It's very nice. I mean, they've got the Science Museum at the same time as all of the exhibits. Mm-hmm. So it's really nice to see many children in there, family in there, enjoying the exhibits and also talking to some of the exhibitors about air pollution, about renewables, about energy storage and about wildlife. It's done really well.
What have you had time to experience so far since this is your first day at the COP?
Oh, really? Only just to go in and have a look. That's been it so far. But I'm looking forward to going to a few events later today on feeling extinction. So a very biodiversity focused one. Another one on the extinction of coal. So lots of extinction on the table today.
Yeah. So, like, zooming out and taking in the big pictures, what are your hopes for the COP as an event?
Well, the targets and the pledges and the words are great in setting a tone, but they don't mean anything without the action. The physics of the situation doesn't matter, doesn't care about tone, it doesn't care about the rhetoric of pledges, it cares about the action. So you need to go from the targets and the policy, the targets and the pledges to the policy to the action. And so we really, really need to see that. So I would like to see much more specifics on the actual policies that governments and leaders are actually going to put in place.
And Paul, you've written this book called The Best of Times, The Worst of Times, in which you outline two possible futures. And you say that either way, this is the end of the world as we know it. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so what I mean is, in the pessimistic case, we are looking at a future that even under low levels of warming, extreme catastrophic climate change, irreversible changes to very large scale systems on the planet like the Greenland ice sheet, even at fairly lower warming levels than we previously thought. And that's clearly the end of the world as we know it, the entire support systems of the Earth changing. In a more hopeful sense, if we actually do what we need to do to meet 1.5 degrees and to limit every single tenth of a degree after that, it's going to be a very, very different world. It's not just about heat pumps and it's not just about wind turbines. It's about changing our relationships with the economy, changes our ideas about growth, about equality, about the voices that people have in society and for that change. Because even if we transition the energy system, we also have to transition the food system. Everything around us and all of the things that we consume are going to be very, very different. And that's what I wanted to do with this book. So I wanted to take the paired chapters of pessimism and hope just to show how the situation is that we're looking at and what we can hope for change in the future. And by looking at that gap between where we're going and where we could be going to, really engender some hope and empowerment in people so that they could understand what that hopeful future is going to look like.
Great interview, thank you very much. It is now my pleasure to introduce the keynote speaker, Ulrik Wesemann. He is heading the policy unit at the International Department at the Swedish Society for Nature Conservation. And he's based in Stockholm. Previously, Mr. Wesemann worked at the Swedish Environmental Agency, Protection Agency, at the International Secretariat at the Ministry of the Environment in Stockholm, and also at the UN Habitat based in Nairobi. So the theme today is building momentum, and this is what he will be talking about. So you have our attention, Ulrik. There you go.
Well, thank you
Wonderful
very much.
Wonderful to have you join us here. And
the dinosaurs.
You have the camera here, and you have Freddy the dinosaur, and you have the audience, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. And thanks for being here and online. I actually come straight from the demonstrations outside, and I must say, that gave me a lot of energy. so much enthusiasm and youth engagement. It's hard to take in, to be honest. But so after this, you know where to go if you're in Glasgow. If you're not, there are plenty of activities around the world. So I'm here to talk about youth engagement. And today when I was out demonstrating, I just realized when I was 14, 15 in 1987, when the Brundtland report was released, I had all this knowledge and information in front of me, but I had no network really. There was not even internet around. So I felt kind of alone, having the information, but no network. Is it... okay. So I realize now that we're in a much better position since there is this global movement taking place as we speak. And it's not good enough. Is it better like that, or? Yeah. Well, so I'm from the Swedish Society for Nature Conservation, and okay, you're nodding now, so everything is okay with the sound. It's always sad when, or it's good now, excellent. And the Swedish Association for Nature Conservation has been around since 1909, and the focus has really been on knowledge production, knowledge dissemination, and also to provide this platform for mobilization, and including youth engagement. The youth chapter within my organization came about 1947, that's 75 years ago,
And it starts really when you're 3 years old. You can enter into the nature snakes, it's called. You can stay in that group till you're 10, and you learn about, you explore nature, and you have great fun, and you are curious together with your friends. And then you move into the next level of youth engagement. We call it the Fältbiologerna, the field biologists, loosely translated. And you can stay there up till you're 25, basically. And it's also a great platform for engagement and networking, learning more about this very complex situation that we're in. And then, of course, maybe our flagship in SSNC is that we work with the Swedish school system. Together with teachers, we develop training materials and courses, different themes. We have one really interesting on beyond fossil fuels. It's now also translated into English, I think, on the web. So, and we're having competitions between schools, between pupils as well, and it's great fun. They learn a lot, and we received a prize from UNESCO this year on the education for sustainable development. So I think we're on track. Well, I also have to mention the augmented reality experiment that we undertook this year together with Google. So you can actually introduce endangered species into your classroom. You can try it. Just search for you can go into our website and you'll find the instructions. So there's a lot going on in terms of the relations with schools. And I think you have the knowledge and the platform again. Those two are needed for proper youth engagement. And it's basically the same concept we're using when we collaborate worldwide. We are now working with 50 different organizations, mostly in the Global South. And more or less all of them have a youth dimension. You have to if you're going to work long term. So maybe I can just mention a few examples. I'm not keeping track of time, but you're helping me. For example, in India, we're having this fantastic engagement from youth in the local development, especially looking at nature conservation. And youth were not invited previously, but now they are, at least in our projects. And we're doing similar initiatives in the Philippines, looking at, you have the education, but then what? How do you take it from education to action? Specifically looking at lifestyle issues, and it's extremely interesting. We have similar initiatives in South Africa, but we are more focusing on how, well, on land custodianship and how youth can also get training on those issues, because they're really important in terms of livelihood, land-based livelihood. So those were just three examples, but I also have a publication that I didn't bring here, but on plenty of examples where youth has been engaged in, mostly in sustainable consumption, because that's a very good entry point for youth engagement. Such in Sweden, we are having an initiative we call swap, cloth swapping. Sounds very exciting, right? But it doesn't happen on site. But you swap clothes, and we don't talk about owning. We rather talk about using and reusing, and it creates a lot of engagement. So it's a good starting point for wider discussions on sustainable consumption. So again, being part of a global movement, working together on a common agenda, it really creates a sense of belonging and accomplishment. And I think those two are essential for transformation. And that's what we want, and that's what we need. So with knowledge, and with a platform, with a network, and with this sense of belonging, we can accomplish a lot. And that's where we're heading. So I think I will stop there for now, but please feel free to visit our website, ssnc.se, I hope. It's not org, you know, it's one of those two.
Well, thank you, Ulrik.
Thanks.
You do great work.
Okay.
Absolutely great work. A question, how about climate education in the curriculum of schools? We only have that in the UK and in Italy, of all countries in the world. So what would take to get climate education into the curriculum, and what impact would this have on the transition needed?
I think it would be essential, to say the least. We're not there quite yet. We have sustainable development as part of the curriculum, which is more difficult. It would be perhaps smarter to focus, but then we are still talking about sustainable development, even though we are focusing on climate issues. So I hope we are moving in towards that direction. So I can again recommend this thematic toolbox that we have developed on beyond fossil fuels, designed for schools, and it's available in English as well.
So listen up, all educators and parents.
And parents, they get automatically involved once you introduce something in to the children and to the schools. You automatically have the parents involved.
And that's a good way to make transition happen faster,
yes,
right? Because
yes,
you do listen to your children.
Absolutely.
If they are worried, and the children are very worried, that we know. Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Ulrik.
Thank you.
I'll let you go now and step up on stage and here to introduce the next video. It's actually a video first, and then we have some more guests coming up. So, Stuart Scott is another man that's also part of the foundation board, together with Greta Thunberg. And with us, luckily, we have Stuart Scott. Give him a warm hand.
Thank you. My main focus is trying to save some semblance of a future for my kids and the kids who are represented by the people sitting here in this audience and people out there watching us.
Wonderful. Well, you have a presentation for us, so
yes,
the stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. I always start my presentation here. This is where it starts and ends, our only home. This photograph, the last taken from Apollo 17 mission, is said to be the most published photograph in the history of humanity. If you had the globe the size of a basketball in your hand, the atmosphere would be a coat of paint, hardly visible. So the scientists' warning to humanity started in 1992, the same year as the Rio summit. And there it is. It was published by the Union of Concerned Scientists, an advocacy group out of Washington, D.C., very well-respected scientific advocacy group. The first sentence says it all. Human beings and the natural world are on a collision course. Human activities inflict harsh and often irreversible damage on the environment. A great change in our stewardship of the Earth and the life on it is required if vast human misery is to be avoided and our global home on this planet is not to be irretrievably mutilated. I don't know how more visceral you can get. I say get angry, get very angry, but not just getting angry, do something about it. Take action. The bottom line is we must all become active immediately to avert a catastrophe for us, for our children, and for all life on Earth.
I've continually been on the lookout for leading edge things, leading edge in terms of the signs of urgency, because one of the problems that I see in our societal inability to deal with this urgent situation is that it's being formulated in the human imagination as a far-off problem, far off in space and time.
You talked about carbon budget. There is a lot of bullshit going on out there that we still have a carbon budget. Not. We have already spent our carbon budget. But the politicians have this, they have this routine down of kicking the can down the road, and they do that by this notion of a carbon budget. We have no more carbon budget. I want to dispense with that illusion. We are borrowing from future generations at this point. We are making their lives much more difficult.
We have to bring to people the commitment, the conviction that things are not as they should be. They need to change. And by golly, I'm going to change them. I'm going to help change them. You know, you have to rise out of your seat and you have to promote yourself to the level that you're capable of in terms of creating change. Those that misinform us say that it's okay, or they pretend that it's okay. That is what I call the defective mainstream narrative. And if there's anything that we are about at Facing Future, it's an accurate, to the extent that we are able, an accurate alternative narrative to the garbage that's being handed out by nations, corporations, banks, and yes, the United Nations.
My skills and my internal image of being a warrior always bring me back to the point of that hope and action are the same. And so I rise from the ashes continually on a daily basis sometimes and decide that I'm going to do something about this.
We need to wake up, folks. We need to get with it and realize that it is each of our responsibility to take care of one another, to take care of the planet as though it were a warm, living being, because that's what it is.
Stuart Scott unfortunately passed away, and this is a beautiful homage to him, to see his work and see some of the clips from all the interviews done with him and all the remarkable work Stuart Scott has done for the world. So rest in peace, Stuart Scott. To continue this video, I will now be inviting three panelists to talk about today's theme. And it's my pleasure to introduce first with us here, Cynthia Riddle. She's Executive Director at Facing Future. Please join me here on stage, Cynthia. Cynthia has a long career in film production and has founded the ECHO Committee of the Directors Guild of America. And your passion for holistic health led to the launch of Children Healthy Planet program in 1998, which introduced school children in Los Angeles to organic gardening and healthy eating. Wonderful to have you with us here, Cynthia.
Thank you.
And the next speaker also with us here in Glasgow is Dale Walkonen. She's host and is executive producer of Facing Future. And Dale was formerly a legislative consultant for the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals and an adjunct professor of communications at several colleges and universities. She anchored the news desk on The One Show on cable TV. And you're also a playwright.
Yes.
Terrific. So wonderful to have you here. And we do also have with us, via the magic of Zoom, we have Rupert Reed, Associate Professor, Associate Professor of Philosophy at the University of East Anglia in Norwich, UK. And Rupert is a campaigner for the Green Party of England and Wales, and former spokesperson for the Extinction Rebellion, and also co-founder of the Green Activists Network, also called Green Scan. He's author of various books, including Parents for the Future, for a Future, How Loving Your Children Can Prevent Climate Collapse. So, Rupert here, and we have wonderful guests here next to me. Let's fire away with the questions. So I'd like to start with you. Could you please tell us in a few sentences what your major focus is right now in your work?
Well, okay. Facing Future is working with scientists and activists to promote ideas and innovations that can help mitigate the climate crisis, or that can bring us together, in this case of deep adaptation or adaptation itself, to unite our efforts to weather the crisis that we are now in.
So this is the focus for you and your colleagues. So of course, in this fight. So give your angle on the work. What your personal major focus is.
My personal major focus is to make this an inclusive organization, to feature the voices of the future. This is giving voice to women, to people of color, to young people. So we have expanded our team. We have a very diverse team, which is what's necessary going further into the 21st century. They are the ones who are going to carry the mantle forward.
And your reflections when you listen to Alexandria Vilsenor and also Anita Soyne here, from what they picked up so far from the COP, what are your thoughts?
On
the youth inclusion in this work.
Oh, well, you know, it's the youth who will save us. They are the ones who are protesting, they are the ones who are most passionate, and they are the ones who are most deeply affected. Many of them are deeply grieving and very angry and very upset. And we need to hear their voices, and we need to allow them some place to come and express themselves. And insofar as we can, we are trying to do that.
Well, thank you. Let's turn to Rupert now. What is your major focus right now?
Well, here at the COP, I'm delighted to be here with FacingFuture.tv. I guess we think of ourselves as pushing the boundaries as to what's being disseminated through the United Nations. So I was privileged, for example, the other day to take part in a session with Dale about deep adaptation. I think possibly the first time it's ever been discussed at the UN at the COP. Deep adaptation being adaptation to the possibility that our society may collapse as a result of the strains of climate breakdown. And also the other day, I was privileged to host an amazing panel of youth activists from around the world right here in the heart of the COP, including Luisa Neubauer, Germany's Greta, and the former US Youth Poet Laureate, who gave an astonishing live reading. And we believe it's through these kinds of moves that we can potentially start to, as I say, push the boundary out further as to what is taken seriously in this process.
So, Rupert, what are the major risks we're facing if we're not including youth well enough for this process?
Well, one of the most important things, of course, that Stuart Scott ever did in his long and illustrious career was giving that remarkable platform to Greta Thunberg a couple of years ago, giving her that tremendous megaphone. I know Greta a little personally, and I'm privileged to know her as a colleague. And seeing her at this COP 2 years later, what's very striking to me is that she's a lot angrier. Mm-hmm. And that's true of a lot of the youth. And it worries me where this is heading. I think it is so critical that adults hear the plea of our children to save our world. It is so critical that we heed their justified anger before it really is too late and it boils into something different. And yeah, that's one of my main abiding impressions from this COP26 in Glasgow. I am actually here in Glasgow. I'm just with you from my sick bed today, but I didn't want to miss this very important event.
Well, hope we get better soon. So Cynthia and Dale, from your perspective, what are the major risks if we don't include youth enough in this process?
Well, the youth are angry. They're angry because their concerns are not being addressed. They're angry because, as Greta says, it's blah, blah, blah. We've seen that in the United States. You know, we're hamstrung by the special interests of a few people. We're all angry about that. But the youth, if we don't get the climate together, they don't have a very strong future to look forward to.
And there is a lot of fear. The organization that I'm involved in, Our Kids Climate, we did a recent survey in Sweden. 50% of the youth are terrified of what's facing them, their future. And these numbers are horrendous. So Dale, when it comes to climate education, I did address the previous speaker with this question. Mm-hmm. What's the importance of getting this into the curriculum, and what leverage can that give to the movement if we are putting climate education into the curriculums of the schools? We only have it in the UK and in Sweden.
I think it's in the curriculum of many schools already, and that's why students are so frightened. It's not in the colleges enough. It's not in the subject matter enough. We're being prepared. Children are being prepared for careers that probably will not even happen, rather than being prepared for the realities of what is coming to them. We also need to unite a spiritual and ethical understanding for our youth who have lost their fundamental connection to nature and to each other. They're on Facebook, they're on the TV, they're playing video games, and they're ignoring, at worst, what's really happening. Stuart was a lifelong student of a teacher named Oscar Ichazo, and I'm sure he would have liked me to present Oscar Ichazo's book, We Are One, How We Can Face Our Global Crisis with Unity. Because if we don't unite, if we don't pull our forces together, we will not reestablish our connections with each other, and we will not have the power that we need in order to overcome the crisis.
Thank you. And on the note of Stuart Scott, how would you frame his legacy? What was the importance that we bring now further into this movement of involving youth and just getting on the right trajectory here?
So Stuart Scott defined commitment. He was so committed to preserving life on Earth that up until his very last days, when he was dying of cancer and unable to even hold his head up, he insisted on one more conversation with Noam Chomsky. He was committed until his dying breath because he knew the challenges that we were facing. So if I could say one thing that would have been Stuart's message to you, it's step up. Do whatever you need to do to bring this consciousness, this awareness, front and center. Mobilize your friends. Talk to your family. Climate change is not a political, bipartisan issue. The climate crisis affects everybody. So step up in Stuart's footsteps.
Thank you very much.
I wanted to introduce our team. Could we bring them on stage?
Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
We have many people here who are part of our team Facing Future, and I would like to invite them to come up with us just to have a presence here at this event. Very beautiful people that we've been working with for over 2 years now, and who we continue to work with going forward. We are joined by a great many wonderful people, both editing, hosting, researching, and in so many ways preparing the world for a better outcome.
I know this is starting to look like the Academy Awards thank you presentation, but all of these people are instrumental to our success. So thanks to everybody who's up here. Thanks to all of you in the audience for being on our team. We're all on Team Earth.
Yay, Team Earth.
Excellent. And I had the pleasure of meeting Stuart Scott and interviewing him online a few times, and it feels like he's right here.
Yes.
Doesn't it?
It was a beautiful interview you did with him a few years back. That was from this program. Stuart was deeply appreciative of his friendship with Ingmar Rentzhof, who connected him with Greta Thunberg, which Stuart considers his greatest accomplishment in life was to give her a platform to mobilize youth, adults, and old people. Everybody has been inspired by Greta. So thank you, Ingmar, for your help in this matter.
Well, thank you all of you for your fantastic work, and I was happy to have you all here up on stage. I felt sort of, you know, surrounded by echo warriors. So wonderful.
Indeed.
Thanks so much, and thanks for joining us here.
Thank you.
Keep up the wonderful work, and thank you, Edgar, and get well soon, Rupert. Get well, Rupert. Let's now watch a video from UNDP.
أنا كريستوفر دكاش فاوندر تبع ريسايكلر دونيشن نحن بريسايكلر بلشنا تقريبا من 4 سنين نعمل ريسايكلينج لكل شيء ويست ونساعد عيال محتاجة نحن اليوم صرنا مساعدين أكثر من 50 عيلة شهريا ونحن اليوم صرنا عاملين ريسايكلينج لأكثر من 90 طن من الريسايكلبلز أنا بدي أشكر كل الفولونتيرز اللي اشتغلوا معنا بدي أشكر كل العالم اللي دعمتنا تنوصل لهون وتندلنا مستمرين أنا بدي بس وصل فكرة لكل ليدر بالعالم إنه إذا نحنا فولونتيرز وشباب عمرنا 20 سنة و22 سنة عم نقدر نعمل هيدا الإمباكت ونغير على الأد كيف كيف انتو اللي عندكم كل السيطرة وكل القوة نحنا بدنا نطلب منكم تكونوا واقفين حدنا وتساعدونا بهالمهمة اللي كل شخص منا بحاجة يكون مسؤول انه يساعد الطبيعة. مرسي لكم.
Dear world leaders, climate change can be some scary images that you see on TV or when you surf the internet. But it is the daily reality for my people here in Vietnam. The last 2 years have seen record drought and salinity in the Mekong Delta and the worst floods and typhoons in central Vietnam. Tackling climate change should not be in fancy words at summits. Young Vietnamese people have been leading their own small projects in their own provinces to help reduce the human impacts on the climate and support frontline communities. And I would like to see the same level of commitment to action from you. When you say that we will build back better after the pandemic, I would really like to see the sustainable and resilient recovery efforts that will take into account all the climate change threats in the global south. Thank you.
Being a youth female from the global south offered me a first-hand experience of climate change negative impact when I had to wake up in the middle of the night to save my life. Until today, this is a reality for most of the vulnerable communities around the world. Our future is uncertain due to the exaggeration of the climate change impact, which when associated with other challenges such as social and development issues, it simply washes away any source of hope. My name is Ineza Umhoza Grace. I am an eco-feminist impact-driven actor in the climate change sector. My message to the world leaders is stop the hypocrisy and actively act now to address loss and damage that is resulting from climate change. The world is watching. Climate change knows no borders. We are all at risk. We should act together.
Very strong message here. And we have these messages every day. On our broadcasts. It is now my pleasure to introduce the next keynote speaker. His name is Johannes Wesemann. He's founder of Allrise. And he's an entrepreneur, ex-Uber general manager in Austria, and manager director at Strudel. He's a company builder developing digital businesses alongside visionary enterprises. So Allrise launched the Planet versus Bolsonaro campaign in October. Allrise is launching a landmark case at the International Criminal Court with the support of the Deutsche Umwelthilfe. It's filing charges against Jair Bolsonaro for crimes against humanity. So we're happy to have you join us here, Johannes. And you're greeted with warm applause here in Glasgow. So terrific. The floor is yours, and I'll have some questions prepared for you afterwards. So fire away.
Well, hi there, and thanks for having me. Good to be here. Great job you do, and super. Just a brief summary of what we do. So who's Allrise? Allrise is a nonprofit developing environmental litigation initiatives and seeks to hold these individuals accountable for the actions. And our mission at Allrise is pretty much straightforward. We fight environmental destruction with the power of the law and ensure that future acts of destruction result in criminal prosecution. So it was founded on the premise that powerful individuals who intentionally destroy the environment must be held responsible. And the initiative, The Planet versus Bolsonaro, is our first case, and more to follow. What this case is all about, and what the mission of our NGO is the law. Simply, household waste separation won't save the planet. And we see at the G20, and most likely, unfortunately, at the COP26, that politicians won't make it either. So it's critical that we, civil society, act now. And the laws which guide us as society are partly decades old or even century old. They were not developed to meet and fight a climate crisis. So civil society needs to use their right and test present laws. And this is exactly what our initiative is all about. use present law to hold those to account who intentionally destroy our planet. That's it. The planet versus Monster, as you said, is a landmark case. We have filed a criminal complaint against Jair Bolsonaro and part of his administration to the International Criminal Court in The Hague for crimes against humanity, for directly and indirectly facilitating, accelerating the devastation of the Brazilian Amazon, with impacts on local and international level. So it has enormous impact on the ecosystem we all need for survival. And his actions have resulted in, severe harm to the local civilian populations that have also a global impact on the global climate. And this is what we are pushing here to make it a topic. So with the filing of the case, we launched also a powerful campaign. And the purpose of running a campaign parallel to filing this case is not only to bring awareness to the damage and destruction being caused by Bolsonaro and his government in the Brazilian Amazon, but also to create a case in the minds of the public and to be able to win in the court of public opinion, which we hope then to materialize into a win at the ICC. It has been the first time actually in, within the space of the ICC that somebody is launching a campaign as well, because, and this is a very strong belief, we need to bring the public in as an important stakeholder on eye level with lawmakers and jurisdictions. The campaign itself is very much focused on the younger generations, since they are the ones who care and understand, and we heard that from speaker before me, that they have the sort of the empathy and they have the understanding. And of course, we don't have the resources yet to address those who neglect the facts. And I think the two biggest problems with the climate crisis is A, the climate crisis, and B, that we have not found yet a language to explain it. So we tried within this campaign to be as simple as possible, to also empower the young ones, my kids as well, to explain to us what is the climate crisis. And we are very happy, actually, that we launched it 3 weeks ago, and we already have close to 50,000 signatures on change.org, and it just proves that this topic is hot and the people care about, and they share our belief that those who commit those crimes need to be held accountable. So the big question for us, obviously, is what does it mean to win at the ICC? So we're testing, as I said, we're testing existing laws. If the International Criminal Court decides to accept our case, to start a preliminary investigation, it proves that eligibility of our legal avenue. And one has to note that the ICC is based on the Rome Statute, which is defining four crimes, genocide and war crimes, etc., but nothing related to the environment in the year 2021. It's pretty odd. I'm not a lawyer, and that struck me. So I said, let's try to use existing law. Let's try the crimes against humanity. So this is sort of what we're waiting for. If the International Criminal Court rejects our case, we will ask whether simply rejecting a crime against nature is the right way to deal with it. And obviously it proves that ecocide needs to be added as a fifth crime to the Rome Statute. And it's critical that we act now. And as a lot of sort of speakers before me said, I can only repeat a little bit, is that we know the global climate crisis is human-made. And we know what happened in Germany this summer. We've seen Greece and Turkey, the catastrophic heat dome followed by the fires in the Pacific Northwest of the US and Canada, flooding New York, Russia with its fire too. So this is really a global climate crisis affecting all of us. And it's knocking on our doors. So that's why it's so vital to test the present law, whether it's sufficient to meet this climate crisis. So Bolsonaro's crime is pretty simple. He's destroying an ecosystem we need to survive. And without the Amazon and obviously other big tropical forests and ecosystems in Asia, we are in essence up shit creek. And this is sort of what drives us as an organization. It's about 50 people now involved. And we all share the same belief. The timing has never been better. And I think it's a sort of an honest attempt to challenge existing law. And then just to finish is that obviously now more than ever, we need to be part of a conversation and keep pressure on our governments. And a great example, obviously, is the latest deforestation pledge signed at COP26 just this week. And it's I did not cry when I read it, but while the commitment by the world leaders may sound positive to some, context needs to be given. Nothing should have prevented any government since adoption of the Paris Agreement in 2015 to exactly fulfill already by now what now ends up in other commitment to be achieved in 9 years from now. Why is that? Even considering that deforestation continues to take place another 9 years when the world faces a climate and biodiversity crisis, is another demonstration of failure and ignorance toward the situation we face. And this is exactly what I sort of push forward, is we need to use the law to fight those who intentionally destroy this planet. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Johannes. Extremely important and brave and groundbreaking work you're doing. A question, how is your collaboration with the Ecocide Law Alliance and also the Faith Alliance for Ecocide?
Well, we have Kate McIntosh on the board. She's also very much aligned with the Stop Ecocide campaign. What they do is just fantastic. I think it's just, they do it their way. They just came up with a definition, as you all know, of the ecocide. It's just that the big question is, how long will it take? And I think we need to be multitasking. They do and sort of try to change the Rome Statute. We now use present law and push forward. So this is just another instrument, but we follow the same goal.
So Johannes, the timeline for this, can you just run it by us?
The timeline.
Well, I guess it's not really easy to say, but what are your thoughts?
It's a difficult answer. Yeah? But I think, I mean, let's sort of frankly, we have three similar cases running before the ICC. Three were filed by indigenous organizations, one in 2019, two this year. Always, you know, to protect the homelands of the indigenous people. The point of distinction is here that we brought an international level, also showing the impact on the global climate. And when we look at the one filed in 2019, back in the end of 20, which is last year, it was not rejected. So it moved on to the next step of a preliminary investigation. Well, that's fantastic. So we can see that there's some sort of a process now running within the ICC. And given the fact that we have a new officer of prosecution at the ICC who's joined in June this year, Karim Khan, we believe that, and as I said, the timing could not be better, that we can, you know, expect a first statement Q1, Q2 next year. Maybe I'm naive, but I think that's sort of an honest belief again.
Well, fingers crossed and everything. This is could be a groundbreaking decision if it goes the right way and it really goes all the way and can be implemented. So thank you for your fantastic work, Johannes. And we'll keep watching your work and follow. And let's just hope that you have the 100%. We have 100% success in this.
Yeah, so do I. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you for joining us.
All right.
Nick Nuttall, please join me. And I'm going to step down for a bit so you can introduce the next speaker.
Yes, it's with great pleasure that I'm going to introduce Kathleen Rogers, who is president of EarthDay.org, formerly known to some as the Earth Day Network, which is still a network, of course. Kathleen's worked for more than 20 years as an environmental attorney and advocate. Under her leadership, EarthDay.org has become a year-round policy and active organization, reaching 192 countries and mobilizing something like 1 billion people in environmental action. Kathleen and her team have been spearheading for almost 2 years a campaign to encourage governments at COP26 to make climate education compulsory in all schools worldwide. So Kathleen, let me just turn to you. Why is climate change education so critical for meeting the goals of the Paris Climate Agreement?
Well, I think if you look at history, every revolution from the Industrial Revolution to the space race to the tech revolution to the democracy revolutions, governments have put and invested billions and billions of dollars into educating people, K through 12 students, university students, about the issue, either to take advantage of the opportunity or to deal with the risk. Unfortunately, that hasn't happened in climate change, and not a single country on the planet has gotten their act together to develop curricula that will do just that, provide an equitable and honest education for students, but also not leave anybody behind. So our campaign, which now has about 450 million people signed onto it, including most of the major unions in the United States and around the world, as well as 32.6 million teachers through Education International, we're all calling for the same thing: mandatory assessed climate literacy, civic engagement skills, and jobs training. And for us, civic engagement skills are critical because the worst of climate change will be visited on the poor. And not a single country teaches civics either, beyond voting. And so we've tied civic engagement tools to climate literacy, both, again, to allow students, and as they move through the system, to engage, ask questions, become entrepreneurs. And we're also connecting it to jobs training. So while this COP, there was a lot more going on than previous COPs, and I've been to many, many, it was still a huge disappointment.
Yeah. I mean, it's quite interesting, isn't it? Because climate education, I think some of the governments see it as a kind of slightly soft policy for acting on climate change. But when you look at some of the research of the Brookings Institute, based on some underlying scientific papers, and when you look at some of the papers from a network of scientists, including Johan Rockström from the Potsdam Institute, both of them talk about you can't meet the Paris Agreement over the long haul, the 2050 targets, without climate education, and that the actual huge numbers of gigatons that would actually be taken out of the system if everybody was educated around the world, these seem to just slip by in the slipstream of the corridors among the governments. They seem to have not even recognized the pure power of climate education to actually change the dynamics of the climate change story.
And truthfully, education's always been the poor stepchild of every government. They spend billions, billions, trillions on defense, but leave teachers and students behind always in every single country, with a couple of exceptions that we all know about. The education system is failing their children. But this is different. It combines a massive overhaul of the economy. It's going to happen. It's happening to us. We may not see it. But it also, there are genuine threats for so many communities. And most kids are left in the dark, which adds to the whole conversation about climate anxiety, the lack of job preparedness, the inability to take on governments, corporations, or local elected officials. So there's every reason in the world to do that. Now, Earth Day issued a report, and our partner, Education International, that represents the 32 million teachers, we both separately put out reports on the NDCs, and not a single country. They all flunked, which I love that education term. In fact, Education International study actually put the countries on a curve. They weighted them as if they were taking a test. But still, even with giving them the benefit of the doubt, not a single country has really addressed climate literacy in their NDCs. We don't want it relegated to the ACE provisions of the climate agreement. For the most part, there's not any money there. So we really want to see countries step it up and commit. Now, at this COP, Great Britain stepped forward. The details are a little weak, but they are one of the first countries, in addition to Italy, to begin to address the problem. It's all going to be about money, political will, taking the politics out of education and climate, so that you can really give our kids a good deal.
Yeah. Because right now, the young people are educating themselves about climate change, or if they're lucky, in some schools they've got a passionate teacher, or maybe they have the eco-schools movement. But whatever it is, all these efforts that are going on are filling a vacuum left by sovereign governments that are leaving the children behind. Every year that these kids come out of school and take a job or go on to further education, they are being handicapped in the new economy, in the green economy, yeah?
Absolutely, and that'll apply to the global south in a way. It won't in the rich countries. Somehow the rich countries will survive, and those, and I see the same pattern emerging where that we saw in the tech revolution, where a handful of companies own it all, and we're all whistling Dixie, so to speak, nice American expression, to think that that's not happening right now. So there's no reason, I say this all the time, why Botswana or Panama or name the country can't be making their own solar panels. They just have, again, have to have the political will, make the investments, and sit down and talk to teachers and engage them. And in terms of the COP, and this is true whether it's the mayors or students, the youth groups, but teachers need to be at the table. Those institutions that are leading half the world's population right now through the K-12 and university system or pre-K are completely missing in action. And there have been a lot of complaints here about, from everybody, about needing formal representation in these discussions. And we believe teachers and administrators and others, universities, belong there because they have that responsibility to convert the old economy to a new one and come up with a new generation of people who will build back better.
My last question. If we had these 192 countries lined up here right now, I was always saying, what would you do to them? But maybe not what you would do to them. What would you, what would you actually say to them? What's the line that you would give them right now?
I think it's part two. If you're in the North, if you're giving lip service to supporting the Global South and supporting building a green economy, then you have a responsibility not just to institute it yourself, but also provide the funding, the extra funding that's needed to facilitate that conversion. And if you're the Global South, I would get really angry that you aren't, number one, that you haven't been smart enough in a way to include it and demand it, but also that it should be part of the package of what the Global South deserves to get as part of their climate, in order to solve the climate crisis in their country. So it's both, you know, the commitment and also the real need to promise countries that are less fortunate and need and can, you know, build an economic system that's fair, that funding has to be along with it. But they need to do it now. This is not something that's going to take 30 years. I hear this all the time. People say it's going to take 30 years.
Yeah, they say with education, it takes too long.
There are half the world's population. We're talking billions of kids. And over time, these kids, in the next 3 years, you could educate hundreds of millions of kids and graduate them, at least with basic information. Teach them to be entrepreneurs and not leave them behind, because they're moving out into a system that they won't recognize 10 years from now.
Yeah, exactly. Catherine Rogers, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
And we really hope this work does progress over time, and you're doing great work. Thank you.
It's now time for a second panel here on this broadcast, and it's my pleasure to invite here up on stage another very, very unique youth activist, Sophia Mathur. She is from Canada, and she started with environmental lobbying at the age of 7. And this work has taken her to the US Congress and also to the Canadian Parliament. And Sophia's organization is Citizens Climate Lobby. And Sophia embraced Greta Thunberg's call for youth climate action on November 2nd in 2018. And she was the first youth outside of Europe to initiate Fridays for Future strikes from the first day of the action. So please join me here on stage, Sophia Mathur. Wonderful, wonderful to see you here, Sophia. And you have an organization called Echo Justice that you're involved with. It's one of 7 young people that are challenging the Ford government in court for weakening Ontario, that's a part of Canada where you're from, their 2030 climate target. All right, let's turn to Nairobi. We have with us in Nairobi, we have Geoffrey Mboya, who's youth advisor for We Don't Have Time. And he's also a climate activist from low-lying land in Nairobi. And George has felt firsthand, he's felt the climate crisis on the impacts on in his neighborhood in forms of environmental degradation around where he lives and where he works. And inspired by his background, Geoffrey advocates for the connection between climate action and also climate action and poverty. And he speaks passionately and urgently about social justice, environmental protection, climate change, indigenous rights, and more. So wonderful to see you here, George. Let's see if we can get footage. Here's the studio. Here you are. Wonderful. Lovely to have you with us. And you're very, very much involved in We Don't Have Time in the movement in Kenya. And on Zoom, we will also have with us Nishad Shafi. He is executive director at the Arab Youth Climate Movement in Qatar. And he's an environmentalist, speaker, and societal change advocate. And he's best known for his work on environmental and climate change activism and policy in the Middle East. And Nishad was distinguished as one of the world's 100 most influential people in climate policy in 2019. And currently he's co-founder and executive director, as I mentioned, at the Arab Youth Climate Movement in Qatar. So let's see if we can connect with Nishad. Yes, I can see you. Terrific. So I'd like to start with you, Sophia. In a few sentences, tell us about what you're focusing now on, what your work is really entails right now. You're a student, obviously, but you do work a lot, and I've followed your work for many years now, and it's fantastic. So your main focus here at the COP, what is this?
So my main focus here at the COP is probably to interact and with politicians. I definitely think that at the end of the day, what we really want to see is action from politicians and action from them. So mostly just lobbying, talking to them, and just attending events here at COP to listen and to understand more.
So Sophia, do you feel that you have been given access to the right people to talk to? Has it been easy to sort of collaborate with other youth activists and also with decision makers?
So this is my first COP, and I'm only an observer, so I can't go to a lot of events, but I've also met with many other youth that are out protesting right now and are on other panels and getting involved with things like that. So definitely I've had the chance to meet with other youth and also getting involved in the many panels and many things that are going on here.
Excellent. We're very happy to have you. And over to Jeffrey. Please tell us about the focus of your work right now, Jeffrey.
Yeah, I'm really excited to be part of this panelist and to build on that momentum and also to contribute to this conversation. So basically, my work touches on urban informal settlements, where I work with communities across Nairobi using citizen initiative, whereby I urge and work with local people in coming up with projects that support climate adaptation and mitigation processes. And this involves hosting a number of community forums where I lead this conversation with other brilliant young people and also leaders, where we enable community members to come up with their own to talk about the issues surrounding their community and also to guide them through coming up with toolkits and also mechanism to, of course, tackle the issues they face. And so far, we've been able to achieve a lot in terms of ensuring we're cleaning up the rivers. We are planting also trees across riverbanks to enable a green future. And this kind of initiative have really gained much attention because we realize that urban informal settlements are really missing out in conversation at all levels, including local level, at regional, even at country. You see, I was checking a recent report whereby we see the NDCs where they have aligned or outlined the programs at community level. But if you visit these urban settlements, you'll find a big gap, and you'll find that indeed they are missing actions. And so enabling communities to have their own initiative, it's been really amazing and a great effort from us. Yeah. And I'd love to point out that these urban informal settlements are namely Kibera, Dandora, and Matare, and also Mukuru, where I come from. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Geoffrey. And you can follow Geoffrey's work on the We Don't Have Time platform. He posts regular great stories about the achievements and the work he does with his colleagues and the activists he works with. So let's turn to Nishad. What is your focus right now?
Well, thank you for having me here. We don't make time. We are absolutely great to have me to represent Arab Youth Climate Movement Qatar. Our basic idea is to work with the young community, especially like how the Earth Network just mentioned on education. We have been established since 2015. Since Paris Agreement, COP21. Why was we established was a regional network. After I attended my first COP back in 2015, I realized there was a big vacuum of young people from the Arab region, and still there is a huge vacuum of young people from the Arab region at the global climate conversation. The idea was not only to have be part of the global conversation, but also at the local level, how do you take those information, what you gain from attending such conferences back into your respective country, how you disseminate those information on a layman language to the local people. The idea was to our organization was to host community events. Our one of the initiatives back in 2015 was Earth Talk series, where it was one of its kind to invite international speakers to come to Qatar and to deliver impact of climate change from activist point of view, but a scientific point of view. And at the same time, we also invited UN diplomats. And just to update on education perspective, just before the COP, we announced a release of our first environmental footprint app. It's an application where you can measure your footprint, your personal impact on the environment. This sort of app is the first of its kind in the Gulf, in the Middle East as such. Mostly people use a sort of app which you find online, but this was exclusively made by Arab Youth Climate Movement to measure your impact. So to give a sort of idea how much impact you have from an individual perspective, nevertheless, you know, we know who's the elephant in the house, but still we wanted to give a sort of education to young people. And this program was exclusively launched at school. The idea was to young people to understand the gravity of environmental impacts, to just to show how much your footprint has an impact and just to see how much our industry level would have. So the way we are trying to do is to bring more young people in the forefront, not only just being an activist, but understanding of the gravity of the impact at a very ground level.
So a question to all three of you. I'll start with you, Nishad. What are the major obstacles to get even more out of your movements? And what do you need from whom?
Well, we, of course, need a lot of support from Global North and our respective governments in the region. Of course, we've been known to be the big elephant, sometimes being the oil and gas rich countries in our part of the world. Of course, it's necessary because our economy runs on that at that point of time, but alternatives are not cheap. And of course, the cry from our governments is to have this technology transfer as soon as possible to make their energy transition to decarbonize. It's great to see a lot of discussion happening from the Middle East as such. We have been seeing latest the net zero emission, net zero plans from Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Bahrain, and also Qatar announcing 25% emission reduction by 2030 are like very, very ambitious from super fossil fuel based countries. And I acknowledge that commitment, but we have to let and see how it works in the coming days. But for us as a young activist and youth community here, we don't have many, and we represent that voice of the Arab youth to make sure that this reaches to the right ears of our leaders, and also the leaders from the Global North who can, you know, use the diplomacy or, you know, use their political power to translate those information to our leaders to work together, to exchange ideas, to together to bring that change we are looking at. So Arab Youth Climate Movement calls the leaders at the COP26 to work with our respective governments to make sure that, you know, nobody's left around. And also one of the things is education and how education, ministry and environment can work together. And to highlight the project which I just mentioned, the carbon footprint application we just launched, is launched with support of Ministry of Environment and Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education. And we see how much they are correlated. So what I call at this point of time is to how we can work collectively, and nobody should be left behind as far as still, I believe, Global South, including the West Asia, are left apart.
Well, thank you very much. I'm turning now to Sophia. For your movement, your actions to be amplified and taken into even more account, what do you need and from whom?
Well, it's less, well, obviously what we need is climate action, but I think one of the main problems I've seen within my activism is people not taking me as a 14-year-old seriously, especially when I was...
You have 7 years of experience already.
Yeah, yes. I mean, when I started my activism, I was only 7 or 8 years old, and you could see when I would walk into politicians' offices to go lobbying, they would not look at me seriously because they're not used to seeing youth in this movement. And eventually, as I was going lobbying, I could see that I was having an impact on the politicians eventually, because since they're not used to seeing youth there, once they hear me talking and I used to draw drawings that would say climate change is real, or a carbon tax is a perfect solution with a little cat, and many other messages like that. And when I go back to their offices to this day, they still have those little drawings. And as you can see, that is having an impact on them. And I really think that, yes, we're being taken seriously by those politicians, but we also want to be taken seriously here at COP. And, we want to see, people looking at the protests that are happening right now and take us seriously and listen to us youth, because our voices matter and this is going to affect us.
Indeed it will. Well, thank you very much, Sophia. Jeffrey, what do you need and from whom?
I think it's a critical question, which I would love to answer in three ways. One would be to open up more spaces and more platforms whereby we could contribute to our inputs and also some of our priorities, because we believe at such pivotal moments such as COP26, it's such a big platform whereby we could be able to raise some of the issues affecting such communities, because indeed, putting people who are mostly affected at the heart of this conversation, in the mainstream media and publication, would be really critical moving forward. Also, I think climate financing for urban poor is really critical, in that coming up with ways, innovative ways, and also working with local communities by, for example, funding their projects would be really a great way to reach the people in order to achieve sustainable development goals, which emphasize much on adaptation and mitigation processes for our community at such places.
Well, thank you very much, Geoffrey, and thank you very much, Ashid, from Qatar, and thank you very much, Sophia Mather, for joining us here today. And Sophia, you will be around for how many days more at the COP?
Well, I'm leaving on Wednesday, so I'm not staying for the full 2 weeks, but I've gained a lot of information. I'm hoping when the politicians go back home that they take action, so... Yeah.
Well, thanks for joining us here in Glasgow, and thanks for joining us online, Geoffrey, and also great to have you with us, Nishad from Qatar. Keep up the fantastic work. We need more people like you in the world, that's for sure. Thanks a lot, Sophia.
Thank you.
We are now turning to our hubs, and we're very fortunate because we will be listening now to a recorded interview with a U.S. Senator, Senator Kasten, who will be introduced by Shweta Chakraborty in Washington, D.C.
Hello from the We Don't Have Time, Washington, D.C. hub. I'm really excited to have with me here today U.S. Congressman Sean Kasten. Representative Kasten, you are a scientist.
You're a star.
You are a clean energy entrepreneur and a CEO. And now as a member of Congress, representing western suburbs of Chicago, you've dedicated your life to fighting climate change. So it's really prudent for us to ask you a little bit about your thoughts regarding how COP is going. We're about a week in now. So from your vantage point as a US policymaker, what are your thoughts about the takeaways from COP so far?
Every time we have one of these conferences, you sit there and say, we have scientists who understand what's necessary. We have a handful of countries who acknowledge what's necessary. We have a handful of countries and politicians who are in full denial. And then a handful who say, I would like credit for being patted on the back for doing what was politically possible. Mm. And, the good news is that we're at this COP with a with more people flowing into that good camp of what's necessary. So we've seen a huge increase in the commitments. Trillions of dollars of private capital has been committed at this COP. We're seeing a steady rollout of the NDCs. I think one of the biggest pieces is this commitment to eliminate methane, which is 80 times as potent a greenhouse gas over 10 years as CO2. And yet we're not there yet, right? We still need to get farther than where we have, because the reality is we've already overshot. And I think a part of why we're making so much more progress at this COP is because that which was academic 5 years ago is now people's reality. The fires in the West are the reality for peoples in the West. And oh, by the way, the fires in Australia are bigger. And oh, by the way, the fires in Siberia are even bigger than that. So people who could deny that this was theoretical are now having to confront it. And it's a good thing that's creating urgency, but I wish people would have listened to the science before it got to this point.
Yeah, I mean, we really had to wait for it to get into our backyard for us to act on it, but no better time than the present, even if we should have done it sooner. So as somebody who has a unique background, especially in finance, you have led three bills through Congress during your time as a congressman, and on protecting the financial system and the broader economy against climate change. So can you tell us more about these bills?
Sure, and I should clarify that we've got one all the way through the House. This was the Climate Financial Risk Act, which would essentially standardize the way that companies report both their contributions to climate change and their exposure. And that's really a setup for the second one, which is dealing with the systemic risk to our financial system that we've been doing with Senator Schatz. But it's all around the fact that the addressing climate change is urgent because the costs are massive if we don't. We spent $100 billion just in the United States just this year dealing with floods and wildfires. But as against that, addressing climate change is a way to make all of us really rich.
Yeah.
Because if you don't have to buy fossil fuel, there's this really cool thing, and this is complicated for some of my Republicans to understand, but if you don't have to buy fossil fuel, you don't have to pay for fossil fuel. It's pretty sweet.
Right.
You save a lot of money. But that creates challenges in our financial system, because we're going to create this huge wealth transfer from energy producers, who represent a tiny minority of people, to energy consumers, who represent all people. Well, when that money moves through the economy, where do we see dislocations in our banking system? Where do we see dislocations in our insurance system? Who's exposed? And so these bills are to try to capture that systemic risk and put the buffers in place before it comes through.
Fantastic.
So that we can capture this wealth and make sure that it's shared equitably through society.
And this really makes it more stable, too. It's a more stable energy future if we're able to pull this off.
Without question. Well, we're going to pull it off one way or the other. The question is, are we going to pull it off in a responsible way?
Yes, very good point. You're also the former CEO of a clean energy company, and you've spent your career reducing greenhouse gas emissions profitably. So everything you just described really supports this question already, but how are you continuing to do this work in your time in Congress?
You know, so much of it is just recognizing you have to speak to people in a language they understand. I built 80 clean energy projects. I never built, with one exception that was a convent in Wisconsin, that was the only customer I had that said, we're doing this because we care about the climate.
Yeah.
Every other customer we had did it because they were looking out for their bottom line. Because if you make a factory more efficient, if you make a hospital more efficient, they have more money, they have more resiliency, they have more money to spend on salaries, to provide better customer service. And so that was what we did. And so much of this conversation in Congress, and what's been sort of interesting and depressing, is that if you care about the environment and you're a member of Congress, you probably don't have experience in the energy industry. And so there's just a gap in sort of the reading level, if you will, of Congress. So I've tried to be that voice of saying there actually are opportunities in the energy industry that will be environmentally beneficial. Let's craft some bills and legislation to advance that.
Well, as a communications person, this sounds like an opportunity to build some awareness, maybe do some education around this. So thank you for saying that. It comes down, think about how much we could have solved if we just communicated some of this stuff a little bit more accurately.
Yeah, I mean, we had a lot of fun this summer. I think my tombstone is going to read Hot FERC Summer, because we spent this summer basically elevating the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission as the people who regulate energy markets as the most important agency to control climate change because of their impact on energy markets. And we had a lot of fun with it. We've introduced a few bills to sort of help better enable them to go after those goals. And I think I hopelessly confused a whole lot of my colleagues who were coming up and saying, why were you singing Fercalicious on the House floor? And I said, because
okay,
I want to get
cue that clip. If we can find it.
I think I'm the first person to say the F to the E to the R to the C on the House floor.
We really do need to find that
yes,
clip.
Yes.
Okay, so people still seem to think, I mean, you're with everything you're saying, it's seems so possible to usher in a future where business can actually run in cooperation to sustainable and ethical practicing. So people still seem to think, though, that that's not possible to be both sustainable and profitable. What do you tell them?
Well, there's a reality of our politics, and I think this is probably true of every politics everywhere in the world throughout all of human history, which is that losers always cry louder than winners cheer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you are an established oil company, if you're an established coal company, if you're an established, you know, fossil intensive electric utility, you know exactly how much you have to lose from this transition, and you will work very hard to make sure that you don't lose. If you are a consumer who's going to benefit from cheaper energy bills when these technology changes come, if you're a future generation who wants to have a planet that's not on fire, almost by definition, you're not at the table. Mm-hmm. And so I think a part of our job as legislators is to understand the greater good, to make sure that greater good comes, but also to recognize the fact that the folks whose livelihood and well-being and sense of self is tied to buggy whips, needs to see a path to a future that includes modern technology.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And that's the challenge that we all face, and it's why it's taken so long. But make no mistake, this is a massively rising economic tide. We just need to make sure that it doesn't wash some folks out as the tide comes in.
Yeah, fair enough. We're going to save a lot more if we put in the resources we need in advance of these climate change impacts than after the fact. That's also a concept that gets lost sometimes.
Well, one of the numbers I like to point out to people is that Switzerland generates 2.5 times as many dollars of GDP for every unit of energy they consume as we do in the United States.
Right.
That means that if we just got to the level of resource conversion efficiency that Switzerland has, we would cut our CO2 emissions by probably 70%.
Right.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
Like, let's do it out of pure, unadulterated greed.
Yeah. Let's flip the narrative. Where is greed really?
Yeah.
It should be for that clean energy future.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because right now, we're still, speaking of greed, contributing to, by the time, you know, the audience sees this, will probably be over $80 billion in subsidies to fossil fuels. What do you think about that?
You're not even close. The International Monetary Fund has calculated that the United States subsidizes the fossil fuel industry by $650 billion every year.
Yes.
That's as much as we spend on Medicaid. The $80 billion, by the way, and I've got a bill with Earl Blumenauer and Katie Porter to get rid of just the tax subsidies.
Yes.
And that's where that number comes from. You know, I joke with some of my Republican colleagues, like, you know, I think Ayn Rand was a terrible person. But if you love her book,
yeah,
you should embrace free markets and stop subsidizing these losers in the oil and gas sector who can't compete in a competitive market.
Right.
Like, get rid of their subsidy.
Right.
But $650 billion yeah. a year. To put that in context, this Build Back Better bill we're working on right now will create $550 billion in incentives for clean energy spread over 10 years. That's $55 billion mm-hmm. a year. If we increase the Build Back Better bill by a factor of 10, we would still be subsidizing the fossil fuel sector to a greater degree than we're incentivizing clean energy. It's like we're trying to drive a car into the future
yeah.
and we got
yeah.
the emergency brake on.
Right, right. It's ridiculous. The $80 billion is how much we've subsidized fossil fuels since the start of COP26.
Oh.
I mean, just in this week, which
yeah.
is insane. So we have a tracker that will cue right now that we can show the audience. It's unbelievable how much has gone into the fossil fuel industry, and it's just a fraction of what we're contributing annually.
Yeah,
just
no,
this week.
And I still suspect that that's wrong because it's hard to calculate some of the
yeah.
impacts. The Harvard School of Public Health did a study a number of years ago that looked at downstream of coal plants in Massachusetts before they shut down their coal plants. The higher rate of asthma and the higher rate of mortality downstream of those coal plants, they worked backwards to how much that cost the state of Massachusetts,
mm-hmm.
and it exceeded the entire revenue of those coal plants. Which means that those coal plants are essentially getting 100% operating cost subsidy from Medicaid, mm-hmm. from Medicare, from all of our health system that's paying for this. We don't even think about that because it's an indirect subsidy. But my goodness, like, again, like, if you're a horrible person who hates old people, just be greedy, right? Right? Just be greedy, and we will bring about a better tomorrow. And oh, by the way, help a lot of people live longer, healthier lives at the same time.
Yeah. Well, well said. Thank you so much for everything you're doing and really holding down the fort here in Washington, D.C. while these while this conference is ongoing. And the top negotiators, now the top negotiating is just beginning. We've had the country had delegations leave COP26, and now is really when the hard work begins. And you're already here in Washington doing this hard work for our country. And thank you for sharing some of that with our global audience. We really appreciate you being here and taking this time.
Thank you so much, Jetta.
So thank you, Sveta. That was really amazing.
Yes, thank you, Nick. So yesterday we were able to bring in Congressman Sean Casten. And while I was interviewing him, the counter for fossil fuel subsidies since the beginning of COP26 was right around $80 billion. And we can see today, just overnight, we are at $100 billion plus. So this just goes to show how quickly these subsidies are inappropriately being allocated to fossil fuel interests around the world. So that was a shocker just from yesterday to today. We were talking about it at $80 billion, and we saw where the count is already today. Representative Casten is one of many who are doing really good hard work here in Washington, D.C., in Capitol Hill. And we need more representatives like him to, again, pass through this bill that is really going to be historic here in Washington, D.C., for the United States, and really lead the way for how countries can overhaul the way that they use energy. So really appreciate that Representative Casten was able to join us in the DC hub, and we have more special guests that will be coming in this coming second week. So thank you for letting us share that interview. Back to you, Nick.
Yeah, that was really great. Thanks very much, Sveta. Okay, we'd like to go over to the Stockholm hub, if we can get there, and see our friends in the home city of We Don't Have Time. So calling Stockholm, are you there, Stockholm?
Hi, Nick, do you hear me?
You're there, you came in on
Amazing.
This screen. So it took me by surprise.
Hi.
Hi.
What a powerful content tonight. We're very appreciating it here. It was very amazing to hear from Johannes about the Planet versus Bolsonaro campaign. I think since I've started working at We Don't Have Time, we haven't had 1 week during which Bolsonaro hasn't received the climate warning from our community. So it's amazing to hear how they're progressing with their campaign. I have with me Alex Becke from Amazon Watch Sweden, and mm-hmm. he has a comment to give us.
Yes, I want to provide some more perspective. I think the campaign that Allrise has started is very good, and I would be surprised but very happy if it's successful and maybe Bolsonaro is in prison one day. But we have to remember also that the president before, and most likely the one after, won't be good either. And this is because the problem is a system of deforestation when it comes to the Amazon, where the banks, the financial institutions of Europe, North America, the corporations, and even the consumer is complicit and involved, directly or indirectly. So it's good to go after Bolsonaro, but we also at the same time have to look at these other institutions. And Amazon Watch Sweden, together with 20 other organizations, this week actually, we filed a formal complaint with the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, where we complained about the Swedish pension funds that is invested in Amazon deforestation and destruction.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing. Thank you for highlighting how complex the deforestation issue is. And yeah, that was us from the
That's
Stockholm.
That's great, Sarah. I mean, I think it's really important because often so with Sweden, you know, it's like everything seems to be perfect, but then you find out there are pension funds actually investing in the deforestation of the Amazon. So even what appears to be a squeaky, clean country like Sweden has some skeletons in its closet that we need to clear out of the system. So that was
Definitely.
A very, very good point. Thanks, Sarah.
Thanks, Nick.
So that's the end of Voices for the Planet. We now go into the next segment.
To act on the climate crisis but don't know how? With our app, you can send climate reviews to organizations and leaders. Our team reaches out to the organization to encourage dialogue. Just download We Don't Have Time. Tap the green Create button and choose type of review. Give climate love to people doing great stuff. Create a climate idea to suggest a solution. Or send a climate warning to those who hurt the planet. To increase your impact, you can share the review, because when enough people agree with you, organizations and leaders will change. Many even want your opinion, because we have to work together. Do you want to be part of the solution?
So, our next section is Digital Makes Sustainable Profitable, or Digitalization Makes Sustainability Possible and therefore profitable. I'm going to invite onto the stage Ingmar Rentzhog, who is founder and CEO of We Don't Have Time, to begin this part of the segment. Come on board.
Thank you, Nick.
Ingmar, how are you feeling today?
I'm cold. I'm freezing.
You're freezing.
And I'm very pissed off.
Okay.
And the reason for that is that I promised Fashion for Development on our last show in Stockholm in September, on the Climate Week New York, to wear this jacket.
Aha.
It's code red, and we don't have time. And that says it all. We need to move on the climate. And I think it's beautiful as well.
And what happened
but if
when
I
you put
if I put this on, I will be thrown out of COP26. The security guard didn't allow me inside this building with this jacket on. I was actually five security guards really upset that I had this on.
It makes no sense, does it?
It makes no sense because there's no dress code in this event.
No.
People are running around with t-shirts. It's like pro-nuclear or whatever message. But this message about the climate crisis and that we don't have time to act, it's not allowed, and I'm censored, and it's really crazy, and it's so much more to this.
Yeah.
It's so much more to this. And when you're censored, you're not allowed to speak about what it's all about, so I can't speak about it. But I can say one thing. I'm going to talk about why we need a platform that is focused on the climate crisis, and that we can't be dependent on the big tech companies out there.
Okay.
We can't be dependent on United Nations that are censoring the message of we don't have time. Mm-hmm. Or who are calling the shots in this building, I don't know. Maybe it's just the security guards that are freaking out.
Maybe.
Because the code red is actually from the United Nations.
Yeah.
It's their slogan. So they are kind of, I don't know, the COP meeting are censoring themselves.
Yeah.
Bingo.
Yeah, maybe the good work of Code Red hasn't quite got down to all the security guards yet.
I think they need some education in climate, actually.
Yeah.
So what I would like to do today is to explain how We Don't Have Time, the platform, works.
Yeah.
And I have some slides, if we could bring up the first slide here. And I would like to start to talk about communication. We need to communicate climate action. Because if only a few people or a few companies are doing climate action without communicating it to others, we will not solve the climate crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Because people will not do the same. So it's an obligation for everyone that are acting on the climate, no matter if you're a business or if you're a private individual or if you're a government, you need to communicate it, exactly like the Nordic governments are doing here. We're having broadcasts from morning to noon mm-hmm. about climate action. Everyone needs to do that. Because that's the only way we can solve the climate crisis is if we are having everyone to act. And in order to have everyone to act, we need to communicate what we're doing. So communication is actually equals climate action. So we need to help everyone that are doing climate action to communicate, because the truth is they're not good at it at all.
Yeah.
I mean, scientists have been warning the humanity about climate change since, I don't know.
I'd go back to maybe the 60s, 70s, yeah. Yeah, very much so.
Only too few people has listened so far.
That's true.
They're getting more.
Yeah.
But it's taking very, very long time, and we don't have time to wait. So we need to help those that knows the problem or those that are acting on the problem, doing the solution to communicate it. And that is exactly what We Don't Have Time is all about, if we change slide here. We Don't Have Time is the world's largest review platform for climate solutions. We need to know about solutions, and we need to know what kind of solutions that are good or bad. Change slide. And this is an example of how this works. We have a review system where our members, our users, could give climate love if they see something great. Here we have a climate love. If you see someone doing great climate action, you could send them climate love on the We Don't Have Time platform. Mm-hmm. And what you see here on the screen, sorry, the previous slide, if you could back, otherwise, yes. What you see here on the screen is a climate love sent to Google just a couple of weeks ago, because Google decided to update their climate and clean energy policy. So they're actually doing a lot of good effort for the climate. So our members gave them climate love. And the interesting thing here is that in order to have a good action, to have other people inside Google to know about it and outside Google, the competitors, we want them to know about this, so more people will, they also want to have love. And the way our platform works is that we're very, very using social media to get out there, to spread the awareness. So if someone has created something on a platform, mm-hmm. we're sharing it on the whole internet. And if you see that in next slide, it's just an example of this love sent to Google. Have many people inside Google that actually have seen this. 263 people working on Google have seen that they have given love from the outside. That is really encouraging mm-hmm. For the organization, but also for the people that have done this inside the organization. They get a credit. Everyone loves to get credit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it's not just Google. As you can see here in the slide, you have Amazon, you have Microsoft. They're also seeing that their competitors are receiving a lot of love. So they want to do the same.
Yeah.
Love yeah. is some very, very powerful way of doing climate action. And that is something we use in our platform. Another thing we do is that we're driving engagement for the climate. And we are in control of the algorithms. So on the We Don't Have Time platform, we have a user here that have done a test. He has posted on a longer time period content on the LinkedIn platform and the We Don't Have Time platform. And the test result is really, really good. We Don't Time platform have 5 times more engagement when LinkedIn.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a person that is working in with sustainability and have many followers. Another example of how this engagement actually are changing the world is that our users are also giving reviews that are bad. That's something, the ones that needs to stop. And this is an example of a climate warning that a student at the Harvard University sent to the university because they were investing in fossil fuel, but teaching that we need to end fossil fuel. Mm-hmm. It's kind of this dissonance.
Mm-hmm.
And 1 year later, Harvard actually changed their mind, and they're not investing in fossil fuel
right.
again. So now they're actually receiving a lot of love in our community
mm-hmm.
because we're not holding corporations against what they did yesterday. It's what they're doing now that counts. Everyone needs to change.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a great thing. And if we take the next slide here, I have another example. It's not just corporations that you actually can have some pressure and a dialogue with. This is an example of one user that created a climate warning to Jair Bolsonaro, the president of Brazil, because they are using pesticides that are forbidden in most part of the world. And this picked up, a lot of people agreed on this warning, and the Brazilian government became very nervous because they don't like criticism.
No.
People hate criticism. People listen to criticism. Mm-hmm. So they actually publish a statement and send it to us. This is really, really long answer. I don't really like the answer because it's like, why are you complaining to us? Mm-hmm. We are only the fourth bad country in the world. Talk to the other three bad guys.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a good excuse. I don't think that's a good excuse.
There are three other mass murderers.
But actually, I would like to say that it's a good thing that the government of Brazil actually wants to engage in a dialogue. And they're also here at COP. And I think everyone should be here, even if they are receiving climate warning. We need to have a dialogue in order to change. We need to listen to each other.
Yep.
So I would like to say thanks for the answer, but do better. And if we take some more examples here on how this works, is that exactly as a rating platform like TripAdvisor, all those reviews, climate love and climate warning, adds up to a rating. So you can see if a company or leader are doing good or bad for the climate based upon thousands of reviews of thousand different kind of action they are doing. Because companies are doing both good and bad. So let's give them love for the good and warning for the bad, and we will get more love. And the great thing with this, because those ratings, people are caring about them because people knows about them. And if you take the next slide here, this is an example of the reach we have on We Don't Have Time. We have a social media reach with over 50 million that reading about our content every month. So when a leader or a corporation receives a warning or a love from the We Don't Have Time community, they know that it's power behind it. It's people power. And people don't like that. So that's why we need to have our own platform and not be dependent on external platform.
Good point.
So that's why, if we take the next slide, if you're watching this and haven't done it already, please download the We Don't Have Time app from App Store or Google Play. And you can read news about the climate. You can read a lot about so many great solutions out there. And if you're pissed off at anything, you could give climate warning. But if you also see someone that are doing something great, give climate love, because that changed the world actually even more. And the way we are working together with corporation and non-profit organization and also government is that they want the good guys, the ones that actually want to change. They're maybe not perfect today, but they have ambition to change. As in this meeting, I mean, the leaders in this big room there, they want to change, but they don't really do it as well.
Yeah.
So we're helping them. So the way our business model works is that we work with companies and non-profit organizations and even government, everything from the United Nations to companies like Ericsson we've seen here before, British Telecom, Vodafone, et cetera, et cetera. We work with an Intuit that we have as partner to this show. They use our platform to communicate what they do and to get feedback back from a really knowledgeable audience that wants to help them improve. So they're getting two things. They're getting more knowledge on how to improve things, and they are getting amplified the climate action they do so more people follow. So that is how the way this works.
No, I think it's really fascinating, and having known a bit of the journey of We Don't Have Time, how this is becoming richer and more interesting, what you can do on this app, and also the way that you're starting to much more rank organizations or governments or whatever, it really is evolving in a very fascinating way. And you can be part of it by joining the app. You can be part of this journey, and who knows where it's going to lead us, maybe to a fantastically better world. So thanks, Ingmar. Stay with me, because we're going to have another keynote, and then we're going to have a panel. I'd like to introduce now Marco Rodznek, who is the CEO of NOAA Advisors. I think Marco is coming in on the magic of Zoom. There he is. Yeah. So Marco started his career at Lehman Brothers in 1998, where he became the head of European Internet Investment Banking based in London, with responsibilities also in the United States. And more recently, he established NOAA Advisors, which organizes the NOAA Conference, now in its 12th year. And this will happen again in Zurich in 2021, between the 7th and the 8th of December. Importantly, it will include an extended concept of linking sustainability to profitability of companies. NOAA Conference has hosted 95% of Europeans' growth investors and over 60% of Europeans' unicorns on stage. And NOAA and Marco's focus is now on protecting environmental ecosystems through natural capital investments and technology solutions like Juicy Data. Marco, I'm going to give you the floor for your keynote. Over to you.
Oops. My understanding is this is a keynote without slides. So I will try to. How much time I have, just to be sure on that one?
Well, we have you down for 15 minutes, but if you want to make it, say, 10 or 11, that's absolutely fine by you.
Okay. Well, I will try to summarize it. So my story is that I'm an investment banker. I learned at Wall Street at Lehman Brothers. We went bankrupt in 2008. I was working for entrepreneurs my entire life. And after the bankruptcy, I wanted to continue working with entrepreneurs, finding capital for them. Then I founded NOAA. I once said, we are an investment bank with no assholes. So NOAA stands for no assholes here. At this time, we got a lot of fans, and we tried to take the seriousness out of the job. And we did this by starting with a conference, the NOAA conference, hosted over 30,000 individuals. And we had, as you said, 60% of the unicorns. And you have to imagine, you are sitting at, what is it, 80 days of conference over the 12 years. We did three, London, Berlin, Tel Aviv, and also San Francisco. You learn from the entrepreneurs more than anything, more in this 5 minutes before their speech, they share with you their message. So it's a bit like a mosaic. Then COVID came and we had 2 years conference pause, which was, for me, a new beginning. I met Ingmar 2019 at a capital discussion in Zurich, invited him to speak at the conference, and he told me he will take the train. At that point, I thought, wow, interesting. He must really love the climate. And then it started. I became the banker of We Don't Have Time, helped them with the round. And you just hope that the sector of sustainability has people who want to work more together. And I did not see that. I don't see that. And I didn't see that when I saw that there are 3,000 NGOs protecting tigers and another 4,000 for elephants. I mean, it's crazy. They don't work together. And for me, there's only one climate. So as NOAA, we wanted to come back after COVID with something new, something fresh. And when I started NOAA 12 years ago, you said more recently, it was 12 years ago, there were not so many internet unicorns, maybe 3-4 in Europe. There were like 200, 300 in the making. And then we started NOAA. I invited 100 of them. I spoke this morning to Klaus Hommels, who made a very famous line at my first conference. He said, the ecosystem is F-punked up, meaning the corporates are ignoring digital. And Klaus Hommels, who is the founder of Lakestar, is one of the most successful investors in Airbnb, Spotify. He is becoming sustainable. And the opportunity for the corporates not to miss sustainability as they missed digital is really the message why we do this conference. It's one of the many reasons. So where are we now? After 2 years analyzing the climate change sector, more as a business guy, not so much as, well, also as an activist, I'm working against Recon Africa or in favor of non oil exploration activities in Namibia and Botswana. And then I've been working on a carbon forest project in Suriname with Conservation International, which was quite exciting. But anyway, that was just to get real experience. And I came to the conclusion that we need to create a system of data transparency for all stakeholders. And we developed a database logic, which will slice and dice the data from all the social networks. We call it juicy data. We illuminate the world. We try to understand who is working in climate, what organization, what type of social network activity, what reach. We have 14 different impact measurements. We are analyzing it by cause, by region, by all types. Why? Because we want to do rankings of impact by topic, by issue, by project type. We want to provide a lot of data to the industry. Anyway, this is Juicy Data, which is a new project which we are launching at NOAA Zurich at our conference on the 6th and 7th of December, which we do in partnership with We Don't Have Time and many other partners. But the idea is to do a conference, NOAA conference, which is known to find startups which are growing. Let's say at least number of employees, even if in the sustainability world, profits are, there's something between NGO and profits. If you look at that, it's a very interesting business model. It's called a self-sufficient setup system where you have enough revenues, where you have enough. And that's, by the way, very easily possible. And I will give you an example in a second of a very dear speaker at the conference. So we are looking at profitable businesses, or we are looking at businesses who are impact sustainable today and with digital and with doing things differently out of the unicorn world, transporting those into the climate world. That is the whole idea of NOAA, why we have changed direction. We are still on the same boat. We still have the same. We have three stages. We have 25 unicorns coming. We have 300 investors coming. It will be a 2,000 plus people event. It's all the same, but we're trying to reduce CO2 collectively. And Juicy Data, which has a taxonomy of 57 stakeholders, is trying to put almost like a yellow pages, a directory out in the world. There's information everywhere. It's on LinkedIn, it's on Twitter, it's on ResearchGate, it's everywhere. In the media, Google News, so YouTube. So what we are trying to do is provide transparency. So that's one thing. Now, when we have that, the most important, 1 minute left. Okay, maybe I should stop. Sorry. That's probably enough at this point. And then we're launching tons of data products, but that's something else.
Okay, that's super. And we're going to have a panel debate now. So a lot of the other thoughts that you have can come rippling through the panel debate.
Can I just say something?
Yes, of course.
Marco, don't be shy. You need to tell everyone here that you're actually, NOAA Zurich is actually some kind of COP for business. How many companies are you gathering in Zurich a couple of weeks from now?
We will have 300 sustainability tech companies. Out of those 300, those 300 companies, and that's exciting, have raised collectively 25 billion euros. So they have already. And what I love is to have a delivery hero, an Adyen, the largest tech stars of Europe, and then have a cyber tracker from Africa, which is developed with a tribe to count biodiversity. And I told Luis, the founder, I said, you should not be an NGO. You should give this data to all the environmental projects so they can measure impact. Do it biodiversity data as a service. Mm-hmm. So he's coming to Zurich, and I hope we get funding so he can move his data into the cloud. Oh, there's our dear friend David.
Yeah. So let me just introduce David, then we can go to our panel debate. So David Katz is founder and CEO of Plastic Bank. David has been named one of the world's most compassionate entrepreneurs by Salt magazine. He is the recipient of the UN Lighthouse Award for Planetary Health, recipient of the Paris Climate Conference Sestania Community Award. And if I actually listed all the awards he's got, then we'd be here all evening. So I'm going to cut it there. I think that's more than enough, David. I wish I could get a few awards like that. David is the founder and CEO of The Plastic Bank, an internationally recognized solution to ocean plastic. The Plastic Bank is a global network of micro-recycling markets that empower the poor to transcend poverty by cleaning the environment. And the Plastic Bank is an ecosystem that provides an opportunity for the world to collect and trade plastic waste as a currency. Global partners include SC Johnson, Henkel, Procter & Gamble, Carbon Pack, and Advanza, and many more. Very important. Plastic's a real problem, and lots of people don't know how to deal with it. Good. So, gentlemen, we've got three of you here, three musketeers on the line here. There's David. I can see him over there. And I'm going to ask with a simple question. So, gentlemen, sustainability, digitalization, profitability, is this the winning recipe for a healthy global economy and a healthy global society in the 21st century? Who wants to start?
Yeah, I think that we need to, and we have the opportunity to create a paradigm of profitability and change. I have an expression I use often, and it quickly reads, a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. I could try to argue people, convince people, yell at people, do whatever I want. It's not going to create any change. But if that person has their own transformative learning experience or has their own moment of like, oh, my goodness, of course, there's something in it for me, I think we have an opportunity to create change faster. Let's not resist that we don't want, but create a space for what we do want. And I think in a regenerative business model, one that truly creates abundance for the world, will engage more, build more, and have a intersection of profitability and sustainability. And I think that is very available. The digital age creates a space for the exponentiality in it as well. How might we reach the base billions as well to create true, long-lasting, and powerful change?
David, that's interesting and an interesting observation. For those that don't really understand Plastic Bank, what the waste pickers bring the plastic to certain microsites, or how does it simply work?
Explain. Let's watch our words as well. And I think that ultimately it's very important that we acknowledge that we deal with humans. And I think that when we're calling people pickers or even the word waste itself, I think is a part of the problem here.
Yeah.
I think what we get to do is look at material resources and create a global marketplace where material resources are able to be exchanged for value that transfers through the lives of the people who encounter it. A couple of paradigms we work with. And I think the best way to express who we are is a chain of stores for the world's poor, where everything in the store can be purchased using plastic materials. And everything in the store includes things like school tuition and medical insurance and Wi-Fi and cooking fuel and high-efficiency stoves, everything the world's poor truly powerfully need but couldn't afford before using materials that would otherwise flow into the environment or into the ocean. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, it's a monetary standard that's transacted through a blockchain banking application. So the more frequently our collectors collect and return the material, it gets deposited in their bank account, they earn credit rating or financial inclusion. You get a bank account, they have the ability to borrow money, ultimately creating material resources as a sense of currency. That's really what we are. Two paradigms in that I think are important for the world to know. Firstly, if every piece of packaging you saw or every bottle you encountered, and we'll use bottle as a metaphor, every piece of plastic packaging, whatever it might be, was worth $5 or €5, and it was easily exchangeable in your community, do you think that you would see any in the environment or flowing into the ocean? Mm-hmm. Predominantly, the answer is no. If it was $5, of course. So I think inside of that as well, we have to look inside and say, it's not the plastic, it's us. It's the way we've been viewing the material. And during the entirety of the conference, we continue to see people pointing their fingers outside, where we got to look inside and say, oh, okay, it's me, and I can do something more powerfully about the way I show up in the world than what I expect others to do. So I think that's a very important paradigm.
absolutely. And we are running out of natural resources. We once heard on one of our programs that a glassmaking company said we're running out of sand. If you're running out of sand, you know you've got a bit of an emergency on, and you have to bring these materials back into economic production. That's really key. Marco, let me ask you something. This notion of extending the concept of linking sustainability to profitability of companies, when did that first begin? When did you do that? And the second question is, what are you saying to the companies that are coming to NOAA in Zurich in December? What are you saying about sustainability?
Look, the sustainability sector, it's fascinating. You have around, I have a list here of around 50 impact investors who are looking for sustainable tech companies. I find sometimes they have defined their investment criteria far too narrow, and it's not too much of what they would like to invest in, but what's there. You have to work with the startups which are there and scale them. Then there's like on the data side, and I believe you're saying digital is the driver of sustainability to solve it. I believe in it, but I think before we can even start employ lots of tools, like plastic bags should be scaled in the entire world. There's no reason not to have it in every village in any poor country. It makes zero sense not to have it. So I don't understand why it's not being put up by officials, or like there are so many initiatives. If I count the number of new impact funds being raised, but how many deals you can name out of the top of your head? This company, wow, that's like a Google situation. They got funding early stage, and I don't know, right? So investors are far too careful. And the other thing, in terms of the investments itself, why is it now so profitable to invest in sustainability? For two reasons. First of all, people are really looking for solutions. They have to agree. But once they agree on a solution, look, it's a global economy, and every plastic is the same in every country. So once you know who is the winning platform, you have kind of a market winner takes it all. And this is what BlackRock, I guess, was also the CEO talking about a few days ago at the conference. 1,000 unicorns will come out of this climate crisis. It is a climate crisis, and it's at the same time a huge opportunity. And that's what I'm excited. I speak to 7-8 speakers every day. We have agriculture firms who solve it with tech. They tell you, they send the seeds, and they tell you how to plant it. There's a lot of hope from the business side. And one thing is for sure, as David said, if the smartest people are not attracted, if we leave it to the people who are in the let's call it non-profit, it's non-profit, but unfortunately, it's actually also non-impact. And if we can't leave it to them, we have to involve more stakeholders into this and measure. So first data, and then I would say 500 sustainability tech firms, at least from Europe.
Just turning to you, Ingmar, I mean, one of the things that we've heard over the last few days during our broadcasts are that many of the solutions to dealing with climate change by 2030, and that's the time when we're supposed to halve the emissions, are kind of there. But the technologies we need to actually achieve a kind of net zero in 2050 are either incubating somewhere or in a cot, a baby cot somewhere. You know, we don't have them yet to actually reach the 2050. So do you think the things that, say, Marco is doing, and obviously David's example too, these are the incubators that we're looking for the next leap after 2030?
No, I think we need them now.
We need them now.
Because, I mean, everything is happening on an exponential pace. So if we are accelerating the solutions we have there now, with so many solutions we have. We have fossil-free cement, we have fossil-free steel, we have much, much better batteries. People are talking about food, but it's not that simple that everyone can become vegan and that problem is solved. We need to change the whole industry, how to produce food, and we can do that. Pesticides, as my warning before, we don't need to use pesticides. We can use more micro robots to do with it. But what we need is to scale all those solutions. And in order to scale them, we need two things. We need money. We need investors. And people are talking about we shouldn't invest in fossil fuel. But I will have them instead talk about what we should invest in instead. Mm-hmm. And it's a big difference between buying a share on the stock market. You just buy it from another person.
Yeah.
But if you invest directly in the company, mm-hmm. you're actually making impact. You may help that company to grow. Mm-hmm. But money is not the whole solution. We also need the companies having those solutions to be able to scale them. Mm-hmm. And I think what Marco is doing is both having the companies that have the solution that are ready to scale. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of effort to invite the right companies to Nua. It's not just random companies. Mm-hmm. It needs to be companies that have the management team to execute it and have them to meet the right investors. So that is what Nua is contributing. It's extremely important. I will say that what Mark is now building with his knowledge and his network, taking that to the impact space, is as important as the meeting we have here today. Mm-hmm. We need a COP for businesses, and I'm not talking about the big businesses, global corporations you see here on this meeting. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about next generation businesses that have those solutions. We need a COP for them, and maybe that's the seed what Mark is doing.
But there is a relationship, I think, sometimes with the conferences here, because we heard just the other day when it comes to storage of renewable energy. We all know that's a big topic. Bill Gates and some other people here are kind of offering a sort of $1 trillion, $1.5 trillion prize for the next or the new ideas on storage. So then that could also then lead to people coming to NOAA, Marco, with new ideas for storage, and there might be a bit of pot of money over here from the Gates Foundation or whatever it is to help them get moving faster as well. So there can be some cross-pollination between things like this and, you know, your great NOAA conferences, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, we are starting really with data, right? We wanted to give nature a stage. So we have African parks, peace parks opening the conference because they are the organizations on the ground.
Yeah.
Then we are going into the measurement, making money by keeping nature intact, natural capital, absolutely one of the most active topics. We have Pachama, we have so many natural capital platforms. The ESG sector, we have RepRisk. I mean, there are so many opportunities. And the interesting thing is that the big landowners and the corporates, they get pitched many small solutions, and there's a lot of redundancy in the system, which is normal. Everybody tries to develop the number one carbon sequestration platform,
yeah,
but it's stupid. So what we are really trying with the conference, we're trying to make a position paper of all speakers after the conference, and we try to push employment and logical employment. It, you know, protected areas are not protected. We have tech to protect them. This does need to run into a dashboard, like Bloomberg collects stock market prices. We need a natural metrics database in the world. And it starts with a digital land database. We have no land database. You cannot mm-hmm. research who has done what crime to what forest. It's no transparent, although we have that for 25 years digital, and things should be transparent. The public sector has to open and has to give transparency that the private sector cannot hide and do crimes to the environment anymore.
Yep.
It's too late for allowing bad things happening in poor emerging markets. It's not fair for anyone.
Good points. We're getting close to the end here, but I just wanted to check in with our hub in Washington, D.C., District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., to see if they have any observations or comments they want to make on the panel that we've been hearing. Sveta, can you hear us in Washington?
Yes, I can. Thank you, Nick.
Hi.
So it's a pleasure to serve on the We Don't Have Time board with Marco. I know he has deep interest in biodiversity. He's talked about it in this panel. And this question is for Marco and the panel generally, to talk about the dual crises of biodiversity and climate change. How do we tackle these together? And how is that actually good for business to do that? Today's Nature Day at COP26. So really, we're thinking about nature-based solutions and ultimately how investing in biodiversity is good for business. That connection isn't always made. So if we can kind of really delve a little bit into that for our audience. It could be very helpful. Thank you both for your great remarks.
It's my favorite question you could have asked. So you get my absolute sympathy prize. This is why I started this. I wanted to start saving animals. 50 million elephants got shot while I'm alive in Africa. 50 million elephants. There are 400,000 left, down from 10 million. So the number one problem is we don't measure. So you can measure animal abundance or biodiversity by environmental DNA, satellite, you have indigenous people with a cyber tracker app, you have sensors, and a lot of people measure, but they don't give their data. They're sitting out in their silos. There's GBIF, which is a database of scientists uploading animal sightings. We should take that database. Space Intelligence just released their great carbon map, the Space Intelligence, integrate that plus the mines, and then you would have the ability to really start with a chronological order of urgency where you start saving. But it's a fundraising industry, and unfortunately, great organizations on the ground with concessions to run national parks have not enough funding, and we need to change that and to completely reverse the industry to a more output-oriented fundraising strategy. You have a project, you raise money for that, and you have to prove measurement, you have to prove impact. That's the time which I'm excited about, and I want to push that forward with the conference and help the speakers to raise money also.
You know, I began focused on the ocean as well and the marine diversity, and I understood in the end that it was actually a human issue, that I could go and try to save the ocean, but if I look upstream, I'd understand that that's what it was. Mm-hmm. And I think that even the biodiversity, even with elephants, why are elephants being shot? What's occurring in that realm? What source of revenue do people have? How do I solve that? I'm inspired by the SDGs being in order. Number one, end poverty. We're not going to get to the rest of them if we don't solve that first. I recognize that everything that we're doing and everything the world needs is not against the laws of physics. Now, really, if we look at it deeply, nothing that we need to do to solve all of the crises in the world are against the laws of physics. We have all the power in our hands. It's just the will to make it so that's needed.
Good. Gentlemen, and Sveta as well in Washington, we're going to have to wrap up that session here because we need to move on to the next phase of the show. But I think everyone's looking forward to Zurich in early December to see what new brilliant unicorns come charging out of the NOAA conference. Thanks very much, everyone.
One thing I can tell you, we have the traditional investors who don't really have done any time coming. So we have a good start.
Well,
thank
you
for having me.
Great. I've got 50 euros in my back pocket, so I'm looking for a good investment. Thanks very much indeed.
See everybody at NOAA.
Thank you.
Bye. Okay, thank you, Ingmar. I think we've now got our next guest. Jarvis Smith, about Mother Nature. In Jarvis Smith, two worlds collide with dynamic effect. On one hand, a proud hippie, mystic, self-confessed tree hugger, a radical eco-warrior. Jarvis is also a thought leader, an entrepreneur, a speaker, and renowned online retail businessman. His work gracing global publications, he now has partners with and is advising brands including NatWest, one of the big sponsors of this conference indeed, HSBC, Deloitte, Citrix, the Parliament Trust, Octopus Energy, Yeo Valley, and Valeda. Okay. It was in the middle of 14 years shamanic training that Jarvis's true awakening happened during the filming of the 2007 Channel 4 reality TV show Dumped. And that was shot on location on a Croydon landfill. If you don't know where Croydon is, it's actually in southeast London. And the experience opened Jarvis's eyes to the vast devastation human lifestyle waste was having on the planet. Jarvis, come on stage.
That was a mouthful for you, wasn't it?
It was quite a mouthful there, Jarvis. I see we've got an interesting thing here. So Jarvis will talk during 1 minute and the video lasts 6 minutes.
Yeah, I'm just going to introduce it, really.
Please introduce the video.
So, look, today was Nature Day at COP26. Nature. I mean, nature's the very thing that's going to get us out of the crisis that we're in. How have we lost our connection with nature, when every single thing we eat, we drink, we breathe, we wear, we use on our phones, it all comes from nature. Business has commercialized nature, but it hasn't given back. We need to give back. So what we've done with my band is we've created a track with Junior Marvin, Bob Marley's lead guitarist. It's called Planet, and every single play, download, stream, watch of the video, the whole thing, 100%, will be donated to planting trees in the tropics. So it won't cost you anything, and it won't cost the earth. Now, the great thing about this is, and they were talking about tech companies earlier, when you play it on Amazon or Spotify or Apple, they have to pay me for every time you guys play it. So play it in your sleep. Play it while you work. Just turn the volume down. You don't have to listen to it, but play it, play it, play it. And that way we could get loads of money, give it back to nature and plant trees. So the track's called Planet. The band's called The Phoenix Rose. I'm Jarvis Smith, and we don't have time. Thank you for having me. Really appreciate it.
Thanks very much. Can we play the video, guys?
I could never see the sun.
So that brings us to the end of digital makes sustainable, profitable, data marketing and social. And we now go to our next section.
Female from the Global South offered me a first-hand experience of climate change negative impact.
So the question being asked here very clearly is, will tech save us? I'm going to hear some really interesting people talking about this very point. Our first guest is Paul Stevers, president of Think Renewables Group, Inc., and co-founder of Climate Solutions Advancement Network. He is a serial clean tech and social entrepreneur, a Canadian engineer, and an inventor. And in 2010, he founded Think Renewables, Inc. in the United States to develop a series of computer-related products that are designed to operate in challenging environments such as Afghanistan and parts of Africa. In 2018, he co-founded Climate Solutions Advancement Network, Climate SAN, which facilitates investment in climate solutions and supports initiatives to encourage large-scale action on climate change. Paul, you're with us with the magic of Zoom. I hope you can hear me. And you're going to give a short pitch, and then we're going to get a pre-recorded presentation and keynote, I understand. So, hi.
Yes. So, thank you. And now I'd like to introduce you to a range of business opportunities that have emerged as a result of rapid technology innovation that's happened in four complementary areas: the growth in the number of locations where you can cost-effectively store CO2, and a substantial increase in funding for this kind of action. To illustrate this in more detail, I'd like to show you a short animated video that we prepared just for this event, and it illustrates that all the factors that are coming together to create these very large and global business opportunities. So here's the video.
Business opportunities have emerged that can help mitigate carbon emissions on a large scale globally. These opportunities have emerged due to advances in technologies, growth of facilities for carbon storage, and increased availability of climate finance. For the purposes of this presentation, carbon emission reduction and removal from the outside air are both considered carbon mitigation measures. Carbon can be captured from both industrial sources, such as power generation, and directly from the outside air. Capturing carbon is complementary to and can be integrated with carbon-free energy generation. Captured CO2 can be utilized for a range of uses, including vertical farming, as well as be sequestered in the ground. Fortunately, there has been rapid progress in several complementary areas, including carbon capture, by a range of technology communities, such as the key ones shown next. Here are four technology communities that have and are continuing to make considerable progress, but are largely operating independently of each other. This includes the direct air capture, or DAC community, the carbon capture, utilization, and storage, or CCUS community, the energy storage community, and finally, the renewable energy community. In addition, there are several industrial clusters around the world that have or are developing carbon capture and storage capabilities. As a result, progress can now be further accelerated by companies taking the initiative to develop projects in collaboration with relevant technology communities and accessing available financing. This would result in a faster rate of development and scale-up of technologies to reduce carbon emissions. Shown next are some example technologies that have been developed and are being implemented by companies in these communities. The Direct Air Capture, or DAC, community is growing quickly. Carbon Engineering's Direct Air Capture solution captures carbon dioxide through a series of chemical reactions and returns the rest of the air to the environment. Climeworks' DAC technology has recently commissioned the world's largest DAC system in Iceland. Global Thermostat's DAC Plus solution can capture CO2 from both the outside air and a natural gas power plant. And finally, TerraFixing's carbon capture solution has developed a process that works most efficiently in cold and dry climates. Shown here are examples of innovative technologies that have been developed and are being implemented by the three other technology communities mentioned previously. The first is the alum cycle by NetPower, which enables 100% capture of CO2 from power generated in a natural gas plant. Next is a large wind farm by Vestas Wind Systems, which has been manufacturing and improving this technology for more than 50 years. Finally, here is an energy storage technology by Enervenue, which developed a low-cost version of a nickel-hydrogen battery that has been used in space by NASA for more than 30 years. Enervenue indicates that it has a 30-plus year lifespan and can complete more than 30,000 full cycles without degradation or usage restrictions. Shown next are two example configurations of technologies that can produce reliable power to the local electric grid while creating substantial negative carbon emissions. This first configuration example is a combined power system that includes both a natural gas power plant and renewable energy farms. The natural gas power plant runs the alum cycle, which enables 100% carbon capture while it delivers power to the power management system. This power management system is also supplied with electricity from wind and solar farms. To help manage the power more effectively, this power management system includes energy storage to manage short-term power peaks or shortfalls. If a substantial amount of power is reduced for a longer period of time, such as if there is no wind power for a few days, the power management system reduces power to the direct air capture system of carbon dioxide. In this way, the power management system can maximize the reliability of the power to the electric grid. The carbon dioxide that is captured from the power plant or direct air capture system can be utilized in beneficial ways, such as accelerating the growth of food in a vertical farm or be sequestered in the ground. The second example configuration includes a standard natural gas power plant and Global Thermostat's new innovative Direct Air Capture Plus system that can cost-effectively capture CO2 from both the outside air and a natural gas power plant. All the remaining components in this schematic work in the same way as indicated in the previous slide. One substantial benefit of this combination of technologies is that it can be implemented with an existing natural gas power plant. This can increase the utilization of this existing power plant and turn it into a negative emissions facility. There are several funding sources available to accelerate technology development and scale up. This includes venture capital, government grants and related incentives, private grant funding, crowdfunding, and loans. To help companies obtain capital to build a facility, online platforms like PuroEarth help facilitate long-term offtake agreements for the carbon that is expected to be captured and stored by this facility. As well, to make investments in substantial projects more attractive to investors, these projects can be refinanced with green bonds after they are operational and generating income. Shown here is a map of industrial clusters, which are located in many different areas of the world. Each cluster contains a group of industrial facilities and includes infrastructure to transport captured CO2 so it can be stored in the ground locally or shipped to a different location where it is then stored. Most, if not all, industrial clusters welcome new participants to utilize the CO2 infrastructure. Therefore, these clusters can be good locations to build a facility that includes direct air capture technology. The cost of DAC is quite high at this time, but is declining quickly. For example, the cost of capturing and sequestering a metric ton of CO2 in the new plant by Climeworks in Iceland was reported to be in the range of $600 to $800. Some DAC companies have indicated to us that they expect to be able to capture CO2 for less than $100 per ton when their respective technology is being implemented on a commercial scale. Since there are now many companies in the DAC community developing and implementing technologies, organizations seeking to implement projects that will include DAC should explore all their options and select the best ones. To reduce financial risk of their project and gain more understanding of the best options for DAC, it may make sense to include more than one DAC technology in an initial project. The combination of advancing technologies, declining costs of these technologies, new locations to cost-effectively store CO2, and increased availability of funding is creating huge new business opportunities for individuals and companies. Therefore, we encourage you to learn about these opportunities and how you or your company can benefit from them. Once you decide on the best business opportunity for you or your company, we encourage you to develop it in collaboration with relevant organizations, generate substantial profits, and help create a sustainable world for us all. Thank you for taking the time to view this video. If you are interested in more information, including links to related websites of organizations mentioned in this video, please visit climatesand.org/ACEM.
Great. So now we're going to go over with the magic of Zoom to Dr. Val van Lierop, who's executive chairman and founding partner at Chrysalis Venture Capital. Val is an award-winning venture capitalist, business leader, and visionary. His focus is on innovation, sustainability, and clean tech. He has a unique industry insight gained through deep operational experience as a venture capitalist, corporate executive, international consultant, and a university professor. Val founded Chrysalis in 2001 and shaped it into one of the most respected venture capital firms globally for clean tech and industrial innovation. Are you with us, Val?
I am here, thank you. And I hope that you can hear me loud and clear.
I can hear you, yes, very clearly indeed.
And one correction, the name of the company is Chrysalix.
Chrysalix, not Chrysalis.
It's Chrysalix.
That's very important because Chrysalis, in fact, was a very well-known record label, wasn't it?
Exactly.
Okay.
So, net zero 2050. That's a daunting challenge. This is probably the biggest change program the world will ever have seen. Basically, what we're trying to do here, once we started with discovering fire, we started with burning fossil fuels as a source of energy. And now we have to change this completely. We should not forget that in that change, it is absolutely massive. We need to remain optimistic. We need to be very realistic. What works? What works at a certain time, at a certain price? And we need to ensure that we show empathy, because many people all over the world will have to dramatically change their profession. They have to learn something totally different. And change is scary. And if we don't bring them along, populists will arise, and they will frustrate at everything that we want to do in the path to clean energy by 2050. So what could we do? Paul asked me to line out a number of steps, which I call a rapid speed program towards net zero. First, going back to that empathy issue, is we need to keep the lights on. If we don't keep the lights on, we will lose many people. And in democratic societies, you cannot do that. Now, how do you keep the lights on while you basically also almost immediately want to switch off fossil fuels? Well, that means that you have to set a timeline that is realistic, where you say, okay, coal is out within a number of years, very quickly. Oil should be out latest by 2035. That's an enormous challenge. But maybe natural gas, together with carbon capture, we need to continue to still use for a number of decades, because otherwise we cannot keep the lights on. A lot already has been achieved with wind and solar and biomass and batteries, but it is simply not enough. This energy transition to 2050 that we have to make needs totally new things. Things that are well underway, but still needs to be scaled up. Because without them, we cannot really fulfill the desires of many large industries, cement, energy, the transportation industry, steel, aluminum smelters. We cannot help them to become totally carbon-free by 2050. So we have to start looking at what are currently the opportunities that we have for breakthrough platform technologies that can really help, in addition to carbon capture. And then think of things you can do with geothermal. Think of things that we can do with hydrogen. Think of what we could do with nuclear fusion All these things are about to make a major leap forward and can help us tremendously. But of course, we also need to ensure that people and companies adjust their behavior. During the early years of the pandemic, we significantly reduced transportation. We've reduced commuting. We reduced flying. And maybe we should not throw this out moving forward, but we need to ensure that the good elements of that we keep in our system. What is very important is that we are going to look at the finance situation. We're coming from an era where many large companies and politicians really threw a few little crumbs to the development of clean energy, a clean world. Luckily, we have now ESG players, but they also still have to go quite a bit further than where they are today. Most ESG players don't do anything more than divesting out of the fossil fuel industry. Now, that may be a good first step, but I'm not too impressed. In order to develop these big new technologies that we need for the future, from what Paul in his video had in carbon capture and storage, to hydrogen, to nuclear fusion, we need to go much further. We need to ensure that ESG players don't just take their money out of Shell and Exxon and others and put it in Microsoft and Facebook and others. We need to ensure that they put that money to work where we really need it. Now, of course, many of you will have been very impressed today or this week by the announcement of Mark Carney. $130 trillion investment fund for net zero. But is that realistic? I really would love to see the details of that. So, last but not least, I think what is very important that we underpin this change to net zero by focus and accountability. The focus I would really like to see in Mark Carney's plan. How can we focus that money on the big bites that are really necessary? And then put in real accountability. Ensure that everybody who is involved has a salary, at least for about 25%, attached to it, to achieving. Because it is too easy that people come with promises and that they then are not accountable. We need accountable. It's too important. If we do all this together, we can create a totally new energy world. And isn't that exciting? Thank you very much.
Very much indeed. Maybe we can try and bring Paul Stevers back in, because I understand that you two guys are collaborators in a sense. You think together. I don't know if you work together, but you certainly think together. Is Paul still with us on Zoom?
Yes, I am.
So maybe we can try and just tie this ribbon up a little bit here. What do you think is the top line message that you're trying to get across to the viewers of this show, the million or so people watching our show right now? We know there's an energy transition underway. We know renewable energy is doubling every, 3 years, according to the exponential roadmap. We've got the issue of carbon storage and capture, which was mentioned too. Do you feel that you have a clear missing link that hasn't quite been grasped by governments or business or other leaders that needs to be bridged and filled right now?
Yeah, I think there is a big opportunity because when you combine the four technologies into facilities, they then become negative emission facilities. So you've got like fossil fuel generation with carbon capture, Then you've got renewable energy and direct air capture.
Yeah.
And what happens is when the renewable energy doesn't show up for a few days, then you can just turn off your direct air capture and still provide reliable energy to the grid.
Right.
So we're not using, this is not a brand new, device going to the moon. This is like using existing technologies in the right configuration. And now we can engage people in the fossil fuel sector. And instead of going to net zero, you can essentially go negative, because if you're doing direct air capture, whenever you're not needing power for the grid, these things can produce very substantial negative emissions. For example, one power plant that I was talking to one of the developers on was that it could capture itself. If a 300 megawatt power plant running the whole year could capture 2.6 million tons of CO2.
Right.
So we're talking some substantial numbers. And then you look at the people that need to buy carbon, carbon reduction services. So 20% of the 2,000 public companies representing more than $14 trillion in sales have already committed to net zero targets. Now, they're going to be major buyers of carbon capture services, just like Microsoft is. So Microsoft right now is paying elevated prices to Climeworks in Iceland when they're doing a project. Okay, so there's some huge money that's going to be flowing into this, and this is going to create a big opportunity for many entrepreneurs. And the one expert I listened to, and he said that he thinks that the carbon capture industry is going to be growing as big as the fossil fuel industry is today. So there's a huge amount of money to be made in this sector.
So let me just then end. I mean, we have been running a counter on the amount of money that's being spent by governments on fossil fuel subsidies. We started this counter running when the COP started, and today it went over 100 billion, for example. Would actually scrapping those fossil fuel subsidies, which seem pretty absurd to most people, using that 100, using the trillions that the IMF say is being spent on fossil fuel subsidies, direct or indirect, plus a price on carbon, and some properly orderly carbon markets, then you could have this vision fulfilled rather quickly, I would have thought.
Yes, and these would be these plans could be implemented around the world.
Yeah.
So essentially, that one of the critical problems with renewables is that sometimes it just doesn't show up for a while. You get no wind for a week, or you got overcast for a while.
Exactly.
Well,
yes.
If we got carbon capture with storage, then we keep everything running. So the only thing we're going to do is turn off direct air capture when you don't have much renewables. And otherwise, you're delivering 100% power to the grid whenever it needs it. Okay.
And,
so you put those four things together, and it's a game changer. It can be implemented around the world.
Yeah. It's a kind of...
When the pandemic started, the world got together, and we thought that it was impossible to get a vaccine within 4 years. But the world got together, and within a year, we had a vaccine. If we bring everybody together again here, we will have a clean energy situation by 2050. And the beginning of a carbon market, a commercial carbon market, has already started in North America. We had the 45Q regulation, which pushed companies like, for example, Swante into the commercial arena. But now that 45Q under the new infrastructure bill is going to $85, we really see the beginning of a big carbon market. And that may really help that part of our solution package jump forward. But we need carbon capture, we need hydrogen, we need nuclear and preferably nuclear fusion and geothermal as well.
Right.
And if we can bring that all together swiftly, we will be well on our way to creating a new energy world that will not look like my grandmother's energy world, but it will be providing hope for our grandchildren for the future.
Good, gentlemen, I'm going to have to leave you there. We've got some other guests lined up who are waiting. Thank you for being on the show. Thank you for being on We Don't Have Time. Now,
thank you very much.
I'd now like to go to a live guest, Sophia Kiani, who is the U.S. representative on the United Nations Youth Advisory Group on Climate Change. Sophia is an Iranian-American environmentalist studying climate science and public policy at Stanford University. She is the founder and executive director of Climate Cardinals, an international nonprofit with 8,000 volunteers in 40-plus countries that work to translate climate information into over 100 languages. She has been named Vice Media's Youngest Human of the Year, Vice Media's Youngest Human of the Year, a National Geographic Young Explorer. Got it now. And BuzzFeed's Youngest Woman to Watch. Okay, fantastic. Well, Sophia, we're going to just give you the keynote. So over to you. Remember to look at this camera. And you have the floor.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. So you heard that very generous introduction. I'm Sophia Kiani, and I am a 19-year-old Iranian-American climate activist. I've had the privilege of serving on the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres's Youth Advisory Group on Climate Change, and I'm also the founder and executive director of Climate Cardinals. So my climate activism journey began when I was just 12 years old, and I took a trip to Iran. I went over the summer because it's my parents' home country. And while I was there, I was struck by how horrible pollution was. The pollution was so bad that I couldn't even see the stars at night. And so I started to read more about climate change in the Middle East, and I became increasingly alarmed, particularly when I learned the fact that temperatures in the Middle East were rising more than twice the global average. And so with this knowledge, I decided to talk to my relatives. I wanted to confront them and to talk about this issue, but I soon realized that they knew almost nothing about climate change. And so I decided to dig into this education gap in Iran, and I actually found a study that read only 5% of Iranian students could properly explain the greenhouse gas effect. So it became painfully clear to me that there was a lack of climate education available in Iran, but I still wanted to talk to my relatives about this issue. And so what I ended up doing is I worked with my mom to translate climate resources into Farsi so I could have a conversation with my relatives about climate change. And so when I did this and I started to talk to them, I saw that they became scared, they became worried, and they started to believe in climate change and started to ask more questions about what's next, what do we do, and where do we go from here? And so for me, that was my very first experience kind of dipping my toes in the climate movement. And then in high school, I saw that there was all these other young people who were striking, going out into the streets. The youth climate movement kind of exploded. And so when that happened, I started to work with a variety of different grassroots climate organizations. I joined Fridays for Future and Extinction Rebellion. And so I organized with these groups for a few years, organizing strikes in D.C. and helping to coordinate larger ones across the country. But even with this work that I was doing, I realized that that same issue that I had first witnessed firsthand in Iran, I realized that same issue was still so pervasive even within these extremely large climate movements and these climate organizations, because pretty much all of our communication was being done only in English. The resources we were putting out, the tweets, the Instagram posts, everything was in English. And so I knew that we were leaving out a large group of people, my relatives included. And so that's when I decided to start my nonprofit, Climate Cardinals. And so Climate Cardinals is an international youth-led nonprofit working to make climate education more accessible to those who don't speak English. And the way we do this is by translating climate resources into over 100 languages. So starting from a viral TikTok video we had the first day that we launched that reached a couple hundred thousand people, we've been able to grow our volunteer network to over 8,000 young people. Our average volunteer is just 16 years old, 8,000 young people in 41 countries around the world, and they translate climate information in exchange for community service hours. And so shortly after I founded Climate Cardinals, I had the privilege of being nominated to join UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres's Youth Advisory Group on Climate Change. And so as part of that group, it's been a year and a half now that I've been serving on his advisory group. As part of his group, I get to meet with him regularly and to give him feedback and insights on his climate strategy. And specifically what I've been focused on is, of course, my issue of like language accessibility, translating beyond the UN languages that account for less than half of the world's speaking population. But in addition to that, I've really been an advocate for youth representation in decision-making spaces, especially in avenues like COP, where I think that the decision makers have so much influence and these 2 weeks will have so much sway over the fate of our futures, which is why it's critical to have young people in these spaces who are able to engage in productive conversations. So that is a lot about me, a lot about my work, but I really want to make sure that other young people have the opportunities, the platforms, the privileges that I've had, because I think that everyone can make a difference, and I think that young people's voices really deserve to be heard when it comes to the issue of climate change.
So I just want to say hats off, Sophia, because I was a director of something called the UN Environment Program for 13 years and director of communications for the UNF. Triple CCCCC, you know the name, the C's go on forever, and the Paris Agreement. And throughout my whole life, I fought and fought and fought to try and get even just the UN languages translated. And of course, at conferences, they translate them all for the official documents, but reports and things like that, you get English, you might be lucky to get French, you might be lucky to get Spanish,
yeah.
Chinese, oh. Russian, no chance.
Arabic.
Arabic, really lucky to get that, yeah. You know. And you're so right, because people produce all these amazing things, information, often only in English, and kind of expect in a kind of, it's great for me because I'm British, right? So, I mean, it's easy for me, but expect everybody else to get it. And a country like India, I think they have, is it 25 different languages in India that are used? You know, there's English, sort of official language, and one other language, but then there's local languages. So I think that's a really stroke of genius that you've actually managed to get lift off on this. And I think if you can keep pushing on that one, what about the Amazon? Are there people, indigenous tribes that...
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there's so many groups that just are not getting access to this information. And especially when you consider it, like 80% of scientific literature is only available in English, but then 75% of the world doesn't speak English. So there's clearly like this disconnect between the scientific community and the people who are like trying to read and access these reports.
Yes.
And like you were saying, the UN sometimes doesn't even translate into the six UN
has
languages.
Doesn't have the money.
Yeah, like we translated UNICEF's report for them into multiple like African and indigenous languages, and then the Youth for Climate Summit that happened, we produced this youth manifesto, and my nonprofit translated it into the six UN languages because we didn't even have that.
You're doing it when the governments
should
who
be
are
funding
supposed
it.
To be funding the United Nations should pay for this stuff.
I know.
They asked for these reports.
And we're doing it for free.
Yeah, you're doing it for free. The governments ask for these reports. And then they don't pay for the translations. It's unbelievable.
And it's not even like it's that expensive or it takes that many resources. It's just that it's neglected. It's a back thought. They don't even consider that it's so important.
Yeah, yeah. Well, thanks very much for being with us at this late hour. And we have to now go to our next guest, but thank you very much indeed.
Thank you for having
me.
Okay,
great. So now we're going to talk about Intuit. The launch of Intuit. I think somebody's going to help us actually explain what this is all about. And I think I'd like to go to Sean Kinghorn, Global Sustainability Lead. Much of the public discourse about net zero ambition and other corporate climate goals centers on the strategies and aspirations of large multinational companies. But as more and more businesses contemplate how to address their scope 3 emissions, that's supply chains, those impacts that lie outside their direct control and that are attributable to organizations within their value chains, the focus on the necessity of providing resources for smaller businesses is intensifying. To address this, Intuit, and I thought it was Inuit when I first looked at it, Sean. That's just my brain, you know, gargling it all up. But maybe I'm not saying it right, but if I'm saying it wrong, you'll tell me. The leading accounting and financial software provider for small businesses, and We Don't Have Time's newest partner, has launched a new groundbreaking initiative. With us on Zoom, we have Sean Kinghorn, Global Sustainability Lead at Intuit, who will tell us more about this initiative and what they hope to accomplish. You have the floor, Sean, and just clear up the pronunciation of this word.
You nailed it.
Did I nail it? Well, once anyway, maybe. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you for having me, and we don't have time for hosting this. This is amazing. And so, yeah, we're really excited about our announcement. I'll give a little context first and then talk about the nuances of, and we really think the power of the commitment we've made. So we provide accounting software for millions of small businesses. And, you know, we know that we can't hit the mission of our company of powering prosperity without tackling climate change. 90% of businesses in the world are small businesses, and they have traditionally been completely left out of the equation on climate action. Solution providers aren't targeting to help small businesses, and small businesses are just trying to survive. They're trying to keep their doors open, especially after COVID-19 and the pandemic. They're just literally trying to survive. So it's just this massive global problem, which means it's an incredible opportunity. And so Intuit recently committed this past week that we are going to help 1 million small businesses cut their emissions by 50% by 2030. We're starting in the UK and the US and then going outside of that. And I think the part that is hopefully a game changer for that 1 million commitment is a commitment is one thing, but action is all that matters in the end. And so when we talk to small business owners, they say they care deeply about the planet. They understand climate change. They want to take action, but they need help. They don't have a sustainability specialist on staff. They're just trying again to draw new customers and grow their business. And so they need help in that. So education, they need help measuring their footprint. And then the key piece is once they even understand what their footprint is and where those impacts lie, they don't have the time, the resources, or the expertise to then go research those solution providers wherever they are in whatever country or state. And so what we also launched in parallel to our 1 million commitment is what we call the Intuit Climate Action Marketplace. And so every major category that you would find that makes up the carbon footprint of a business, big or small, those categories are in our Climate Action Marketplace. And then we have curated what we feel are kind of the best solution providers that can then, the small businesses can then contact through the marketplace. They can get special discounts or pricing. And so we try to do that work for them. So instead of taking all this time researching and finding out how to take action, we've taken that pain point away and they can go right to the marketplace. They now know what makes up the majority of their footprint, and then they can go right to solutions. And the last thing I wanted to add, which I think is critical, is again, small business owners, that they've been left out of the equation. They want to take action. Almost all the solutions that we've curated in the marketplace will drive down carbon emissions very quickly. They also drive operational savings. The things we hear the most, and this is why We Don't Have Time is such a fantastic partner, is it's actually the most important for small business owners once they take action and they're making progress to get to that 50% reduction. They want help showing up in the world to say, hey, we're climate heroes, and to help them shine a light on themselves so they can actually attract new customers to them. Because that growth of new customers is the most important thing for small businesses to not just survive, but to thrive. And so again, very excited to be here. We are all in on tackling climate change. The 1 million, it's a massively audacious goal. We don't have a clear roadmap. I always say if you have a bold goal and you already have a roadmap, it's not bold enough. Right? So we set that massive goal. The marketplace is the first of many things we're going to be doing to help small businesses tackle climate change. And we're just excited to be here today. And I'm excited to hear the panel next. And thank you so much for having me. Yeah, I apologize. I cannot hear your audio.
I'm going to use a hand mic here.
I hear you now.
There is something called the SME Climate Hub. Are you aware of this, and could you partner with them on this and scale it better through them?
Absolutely. Yes. So we have partnered with the SME Climate Hub. So we actually announced in August with We Mean Business and the SME Climate Hub to recruit as a start 30,000 UK small businesses to pledge. And again, we want to just not pledge. We want to actually then push through action.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, and again, I think the important key here is what we're trying to solve for, it's for any small business.
Yeah. I've got that.
It would make no sense for us to only focus on our own customers.
Yeah.
So when you talk about the pledges and taking action in the marketplace, it's open to any small business, again, starting in the US and UK and then expanding over time.
Got you. Good. Well, we're going to have to wrap it up there, but it sounds great. Thank you so much indeed, Sean, for being on the We Don't Have Time show. And we now go to our next panel. Our next panel is with Sarah Andrews. She's CEO and founder of Vanderful Boxes. Not wonderful, but Vanderful Boxes. There's Tommy Eaton, founder of Bamboo Brush. And Amanda Ashworth, founder of Saffron Design. Do we have all three of you on the magic of Zoom system? There's a lady here with dark hair, brown eyes. Who's that?
Hi, I'm Sarah with Wonderful Boxes.
Oh, you're Sarah with, okay. Well, maybe we just start off with you, Sarah, and then we'll work our way through. So Sarah, tell us, okay, who is Wonderful Boxes and what do you do?
So Wonderful Boxes is an online gift box company, and I also have a storefront in Virginia Beach, Virginia, specializing in green beauty products as well as all small business made giftable and home items.
Okay. And your markets are in the USA at the moment?
The USA and Canada as of right now.
Okay, right. Ah, we've got our two other guests now have come on. So fantastic. Okay, so I presume the top left there is Tommy Eaton. He's founder of Bamboo Brush. Tommy, what's Bamboo Brush?
Hey all, thanks for having me, first of all.
Yeah.
Bamboo Brush, we're a purpose-driven company. We have a range of sustainable products, which initially started with just a bamboo toothbrush. And alongside that, we run educational workshops in schools all around plastic pollution. We organize big community cleanups to inspire and engage communities around taking care of their local environment. And then all of the above fund our social impact projects that we have. We have one that we launched last year in Ghana to combat and utilize plastic waste and really support and empower rural communities around the issue around plastics, in which there's not too much support around the world in these rural, quite isolated communities with plastic. So essentially, our sustainable products fund our social impact projects.
Okay, and then there's Amanda Ashworth, founder of Saffron Design. Amanda, tell us a bit about what your business is doing.
Yes, so we started in January of this year, so a very, very new business. All of our products are sustainable, so we're a sustainable first business. So our hero product is our tote bag, and that's 100% recycled. So recycled plastic bottles and then offcuts of organic cotton. So we only work with sustainable materials. We've now shipped to 37 countries. And as we continue to grow, we're looking at ways to innovate and use other recycled products.
So when we hear about small businesses, what does that mean to you? Are you a small business? Are you a medium business? Is it through the eye of the beholder? What constitutes a small business? Is there some technical term that we don't know, or? Anybody want to grab that?
I'm definitely a small business. So, we're with a team of four, so I would say probably anywhere under kind of 50 would be kind of small, and then up to about 250 would be medium size.
Yeah. But let me ask you, all three of you, I mean, did you all start out with a vision then of being sustainable companies, or did you start out as a vision of, I see a problem, I could develop a sustainable company to deal with that problem, or was it a bit of both?
If I can go.
Yeah.
So for us, my background, there's myself and my partner in the business. We were very lucky enough to live abroad, live around the world. Well, for Rebecca in Asia specifically for around 10 years. And we worked in the travel industry. And I think, well, we over that time, we saw a massive dramatic increase in the amount of plastic waste that was not only having a detrimental impact on the environment, but how it was impacting lower socioeconomic regions of the world. So over time, I guess that enabled us something inside us to start a business to make an impact, and how we can not only benefit the environment, but also on a humanitarian level as well.
Sarah, what's your commentary on this?
I'm a little bit of both. So I started out in an industry helping people with ingredient sensitivities. And so my business kind of started there, looking at different products and meeting some of the vendors that were really focused on ingredient sustainability, where the ingredients are sourced. So I kind of started there, and then from there realized, okay, there's a lot of waste with the products that I'm providing. So then working with various vendors or different shops in my area on how we can reuse them or kind of cut down on some of that waste. And then with the pandemic starting and having to close my shop, I went from about 10% shipping to about 90% of my business shipping. And then the focus is then on shipping and that sort of waste and my packaging materials. And so I started with sort of a very small mission, and it's just grown over time, so that I'm looking at every aspect of my business and how I can improve.
Yeah. So we're here at COP26 in Glasgow, the UN Climate Conference. And of course, a lot of the talk is about these big, huge targets, you know, that we must halve emissions by 2030, to have an even chance of achieving net zero by 2050, which might give us therefore the chance of, you know, staying well below 1.5 degrees centigrade or no higher in a temperature rise. So you hear these big targets, yeah? How does a small business work through halving emissions by 2030, net zero by 2050? Or are you already well down that path and probably racing ahead of the large corporations?
I think from a small business, it's much easier because you haven't got vast quantities and vast consumptions on anything that you utilize. So I think it's much easier. And also that I think being able to engage communities and your local community of that small business to take action is much more accessible, so you can get more people involved around the conversation of sustainability if that is your passion around businesses. I think the next step, what we need to do is how can we inspire, I mean, for us on the panel, sustainability seems quite, I wouldn't say the word's not natural, but it's within the ethos of the business, but it's how can we engage the businesses that doesn't come so involved and natural, and it's kind of secondary, tertiary of what the actual main focus of the business is, which, as Sean said in the previous section, a lot of businesses after COVID are just trying to get by. So how can we take that next step of getting them involved in the conversation to take action?
So maybe I'll put this one to Amanda first, because we're just wrapping up here. It's getting late at the COP. But okay, Amanda, tips or ideas for small businesses that want to reduce their carbon footprint, it could be their overall footprint, however you want to slice and dice that question. Some tips or ideas, what can be done?
So first would be packaging. So packaging is an easy one to start with. So making sure that any plastic is removed out of packaging.
Yeah.
And then looking at your supply chain. Can you make the supply chain more ethical? Can you reduce your supply chain? Can you reduce the carbon emissions with your supply chain by going locally? They would be some of the tips that I would go with.
Yeah, cool. Sarah?
I agree with that. I think packaging is definitely first. Supply chain is a big opportunity to have a lot of impact. For me, I feel like education is a big aspect in mine. I get to interact with customers on a daily basis. I work with a lot of different companies on their corporate gifting. So a lot of it is just, you know, showing them they can make one small change at a time. And from there, It typically kind of catches on like fire, and then, you know, the next year they come back and it's how can we make more changes. So I think the education part is really crucial too.
Yep. And Tommy?
I would just say try and take an audit of everything that you do in the business, so you have kind of a benchmark of where you can start from, and then you're able to, okay, looking at the COP26 and you've got these massive targets, but by taking a benchmark of everything that you consume, you can then set your own targets, and then 6 months down the line reassess yourself and look where we can improve and look where what we can cut back on.
I suppose one other tip would be not to start up an oil company or a coal company as a small business.
Yeah,
that'd be one that. Really big tip, wouldn't it? I wouldn't bother with that one. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, guys. Sorry, we're rushing through. Thank you very much for being on our show. And best of luck. And I hope you can watch We Don't Have Time again sometime.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. So, Ingmar Rentog, the founder of We Don't Have Time, and the CEO. Come on stage again. So, Ingmar, how important are small, medium-sized businesses, SMEs as they often call them, in this fight against the climate crisis?
Not at all. I'm just kidding.
Absolutely.
They're super important because of many reasons. I mean, we need to change our society.
Yep.
We need so many new ways of doing things. And big corporations are great because when they are changing, they could do it with many employees and they have global reach and all that.
Yeah.
But big corporations are slow, mm-hmm. and they're always slow.
Yeah. But they're already invested in one business.
Yeah, exactly.
And supertanker.
And small companies,
yeah.
New companies, yeah. They are not slow. And many of them are going to be the big corporations tomorrow, and even if they don't become big corporations themselves, they have much easier to change. They don't have the stock market. They don't have those big anonymous investors showing up at the meeting where they decide on how to do things. So small companies have a much easier to change fast.
Yeah.
But small companies also have a very, very big challenge. And that is that they don't afford to have a human resource person hired often. They don't have resources to have a sustainability officer, et cetera, et cetera. So they need to do all these things themselves. On the same time, they also need to build their business. So small and medium-sized companies, my experience is that they have a lot of will, they have a lot of ambition, but they don't always have the knowledge on how to do things better.
That's
for the
right.
climate, and they don't have time.
Yeah.
So I think
which is where Intuit comes.
Exactly,
in.
Because exactly. What Intuit are doing. I mean, when I heard about this, I like fell in love, because what We Don't Time is doing is that we help companies to communicate their climate action,
mm-hmm.
and what Intuit are doing is helping companies doing the climate action.
Exactly.
So that's a perfect match.
Yeah.
When you start doing it, we can communicate it. Yeah. So Intuit, or actually, they have high ambition. They want to join 40,000 small and medium-sized companies next year,
mm-hmm.
And in the race to zero, in the small SME climate hub.
Exactly.
And today, I think it's we have 4,000 companies. Last year, it was 2,000 companies. So Intuit, or actually, they are catalyzing this more than exponential.
Yeah.
And when I first heard about this, I thought that, okay, nice goal, but are they going to do it?
Yeah.
But when I heard that Intuit have 1 million customers themselves,
wow.
And of course they're going to help 40,000 of their customers to join this. And so Intuit, they have really understand this concept of, yeah, it's important that you're acting, but it's even more important if you can get your customers to act, your clients to act,
yes.
Because you will scale things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what We Don't Time is all about. Is
yep.
You do something and inspire others to do it, and they inspire others, and here you have the wave of change.
Mm-hmm.
So Intuit is, they should, in next COP meeting, let's give them a big prize, because I think they're going to deserve it 1 year from now.
And I would also like to suggest that we could put them in touch with Sarah from the UN youth envoy office, or where, yeah, where was it? And this Cardinals project she's got, where they're translating, say, UN stuff into 40 different languages, yeah, even in, you know, local languages, indigenous languages. And then it won't just be English small businesses that benefit from Intuit.
No, no.
It'll be other ones, yes, in different parts of the world.
And lastly, those businesses that are joining the race, the SME Climate, yeah, Hub and the Race of Zero and getting help with Intuit, they're going to be so profitable. So you could take Marco's investors,
yeah,
and connect them as well. And
exactly.
You have a lot of...
Oh, the dinosaur just fell off the table. Oh, our poor dinosaur. Oh, no, because actually we're quite fond of him, aren't we? Because he's, yes, reminding us of something else.
We need him to kill the fossil fuel subsidies.
Yeah, but look, you're absolutely right. We're actually connecting in this very modest way, small way, just now. Language, which is reach.
Yeah.
Software, small businesses, reach.
Yeah.
And angel investors, reach. For small businesses, medium-sized businesses. Yeah. I mean, when you start making the connections, everything's possible.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this will be what will happen.
Yeah.
It's not just exponential change. What will happen is fear of missing out.
Yeah.
Because as soon as it is 40,000 companies in the race to zero, everyone wants to need to be in the race to zero.
Exactly.
And we will have super fast change, and that will catalyze things amazingly.
I'm only doing this right now. I'm not just tidying up, you know. It's not just like the end of, you know, I'm not just cleaning up and shutting down the lights. It's because I can see all kinds of strange things being put together just off stage that may need a table. And I'm wondering if maybe Laura Burry could come up and show us something, because it's been flashing at me all evening and I'm now going a bit dizzy. It's a bit like a disco. Laura is, and who's this other nice person that's coming up too?
This is Greg, our tech lead.
This is Greg, the tech lead. Okay.
Brilliant.
So Laura is the Climate Clock Director of Research and Advocacy at, guess what, Climate Clock. Okay, the Climate Clock, it's the Climate Clock, is a climate campaign melding art, science, technology, and grassroots organizing to get the world to action time. Act in time?
Act in time.
Act in time. Okay, that's like, okay, I've got it now. Act in time. Okay. The project is centered on a simple tool, a clock that counts down the critical time window before our carbon budget is met, our deadline, while tracking our progress on key solution pathways, lifelines. When did you come up with this?
Well, I didn't personally come up with it.
Not personally?
No.
Uh-huh.
I just work with the project, so I've helped design the deadline and the lifelines themselves,
okay,
so the metrics. But the Climate Clock project was actually originally started, well, the first, very, very first Climate Clock was started in Berlin. But the concept of this countdown timer with our carbon budget has been around for quite some time,
yeah,
since the IPCC's special report on 1.5 degrees Celsius was published.
Right.
So ultimately, the Climate Clock project, our campaign, was launched in September 2020 during Global Climate Week in New York with a large installation in New York City. And the project's evolved since then. And now we have portable handheld clocks that you see here that,
yeah,
we are using in COP26 with activists and speakers, youth activists especially.
That's really good.
Yeah. So it's evolved.
So you basically go around reminding, yeah, people.
Exactly.
That's really, I mean, you even need one of a bicycle or something with lights flashing going around. I wonder whether this looks to me a bit like some old UN bits of... And that plaque, I used to work for the UN.
Oh, I see.
It looks to me like these are from the UN. Is this right?
Well, not exactly. It does.
Ah.
I mean, the design is very similar. You know,
yeah,
it looks as though something that someone would have in front of them on a podium that says,
yeah,
their name or that shows,
yeah,
you know, something that's happening. But, you know, ultimately, the boxes, these boxes are a tool, you know, for, you know, whether it's a speaker or an activist to,
yeah,
hold, whether it's you know, an event or at a protest, like some of these were at earlier today, actually. But since they're portable, people can use them to bring the message of the climate clock and,
yeah,
the urgency of the climate emergency to wherever they go.
Can you imagine if every town in the world had one of these in the town hall square?
Yeah. Well, we are working on it. So we actually
Well,
we actually have a monumental clock. That's what we refer to it as. We have one, obviously, the first one in New York City. That's the metronome clock.
Yep.
And then we have actually a light display in Glasgow on the Tollbooth steeple that is showing this to all of COP. It'll be running for all of COP. So if you're in,
okay,
the east end of Glasgow, you can go check it out. And then we have other monuments monumental clocks going up in the world. We have one in Italy, and then light displays going up around COP26. And we're hoping, actually, eventually to have a climate clock in every city, in every school, and for these numbers to be ubiquitous in the climate movement.
And what happens after 7 years, 258 days, and three whatever seconds counting?
Right. So
does a bell go or something?
Well, I mean, it is. It's not the end of the world. So this isn't a doomsday clock. This is essentially showing us the window of hope, ultimately. Yep. So it is ticking down. This is the deadline shows how much time at current rates of emissions that we have until we hit 1.5 degrees Celsius, according to the IPCC. Very likely, we'll probably actually hit 1.5 degrees Celsius earlier than that. There is a 40% chance that it'll happen in the next 5 years, actually, according to new science. So what happens when this timer goes out is that we have to reassess and think, okay, we didn't meet the 1.5 degree target that we are all here to actually meet and that we don't still have a plan for, that world leaders don't have a plan for, that businesses don't have a plan for. And so we move on to the next target. We think, how do we limit warming from here? But as it stands, 1.5 is essentially inevitable at this point. It's just that this is how much time is left until it happens. We can put more time onto the clock if we act immediately, not by 2030, not by 2050, but now.
Or 2070.
Or 2070. You know, I've heard. Yes, that was the Prime Minister of India who announced that that target for net zero by 2070.
What's interesting is these are the two sides of the story, aren't there? There's this glaring, you know, shocking reality here.
Yep.
Another one, by the way, over here. and then on the other side of the coin, there is this kind of also kind of optimism as well that we actually can do it. And we had Johan Rockström, the scientist, on the show last night, and he was actually quite upbeat about the pledges at the moment, maybe 1.9.
Yeah.
So we're in this kind of moment where it's all swirling around between optimism, pessimism, fear, and can do it.
Yeah.
And I think we need all these forces at work. The fear of this, the ridiculousness of that, and the chance of what Johan said last night is maybe we are just coming down with our emissions.
And we need to have some fun and laugh.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. So shall we just wrap up the show there right now? I think it's late. Some people might want a cup of tea as they do at this time of night. I'm that sort of person, as you can see. Bit of a cup of tea, man. And I want to thank everybody that was on the show today. And I know we're playing out with some music, and I'm just trying to get down to the bottom of my script, which has gone very haywire, to say music video Ramesses and Selket's song title Life Child. And Ramesses and Selket were a man and wife musical duo who launched their musical career in the late 1960s. In 1976, Ramesses passed away. Okay. In 2021, his widow Selket re-recorded parts of Life Child with new lyrics and sounds. It is a positive affirmation, resolving its message and giving hope for a solution if we each look after our own little corner. Let's hear it. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
build our houses off the ground. Comfort me, life child, so that my spirit could be free, life child. We left you hanging on a hill, why won't we ever do your will?
Each and every one of us, save our planet. Life child, have joy and light where you live. Life child, seek and you will find the answer. Life child, peace and unity all over the world. Life child, think with your heart. Life child, to lead and guide. Hope must survive. Life child.